A very good morning and welcome to the 18th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2024. We have apologies this morning from John Swinney and I welcome Jackie Dunbar to the meeting. So our first item of business today is an oral evidence taking session on two legislative consent memoranda. They are LCM S6 number 43 and LCM S6 number 43A. These have been lodged by the Scottish Government in relation to the UK Criminal Justice Bill. So I welcome to the meeting this morning Angela Constance, Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs, Ms Alison Morris, Head of Serious Organised Crime Policy, Divert and Deter at the Scottish Government, Christy Adams, Policy Officer at the Organised Crime Unit at the Scottish Government, and Ruth Swanson, Solicitor, Equalities and Criminal Justice Division at the Scottish Government. So welcome to you all, and I refer members to Paper 1. So I intend to allow up to 20 minutes for this evidence session, and can invite the Cabinet Secretary to make some opening remarks on the LCMs. Cabinet Secretary.
Good morning and thank you, Convener. The Draft International Organisations, Immunities and Privileges Scotland Amendment Order 2024 is an order in council made by His Majesty under powers in the International Organisations Act 1968. The nature of the reserve devolved divide means that where privileges and immunities relate to devolved matters in Scotland, the function of advising His Majesty in relation to the order is devolved. The purpose of this instrument is to give effect to the obligations relating to immunities and privileges for those matters which are within the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament for two international organisations. Firstly, the European Space Agency, an agreement... Sorry, forgive me, Convener, is there a problem?
Forgive me, Cabinet Secretary, can I put you on hold for a wee second? I think there's a slight procedural query, I'm just going to clarify it.
The Cabinet Secretary is reading out the SSI, but we're on the LCM agenda item on this LCM.
I jumped up.
No, you were fine, but the Cabinet Secretary didn't know her speech on the SSI. I think her officials just tell you that.
Oh, right.
So maybe just say we're on the LCM at the moment.
Yeah. I think we've maybe slightly jumped ahead, but I think we'll just let you get to the correct part.
Right. Just one moment.
Just confirm that we're looking at the LCM.
Just to confirm we're looking at the LCMs.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. Right. Okay. My apologies,
right.
Convener.
No, okay. Not at all. These things happen. So back to you, Cabinet Secretary.
Okay. I very much welcome the opportunity today to discuss the two legislative consent memoranda lodged so far to give effect in Scotland to parts of the UK Government Criminal Justice Bill. This is a large and complex bill covering numerous different policy areas. While we support the overall purpose of the bill to keep communities safe, we have not accepted every measure offered. In some cases, we already have our own legislation in place. In other cases, we simply do not see the need to legislate in a very different legislative and delivery landscape. But where we can see benefit to Scotland, we have brought forward an LCM and a supplementary LCM and have plans to bring forward a supplementary LCM in the next few days and a further supplementary LCM when the UK government tables additional amendments at the House of Lords report stage. The Scottish Government proposes legislative consent to clauses 1 to 4, 16 and 28 of this bill, insofar as it makes provision within the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament. The first LCM we have lodged relates to the provisions covering criminal liability of bodies corporate and the provisions around access to driver licence records. the identification doctrine as a long-standing element of criminal law that allows for corporate liability in situations where a person representing the directing mind and will of an organisation has committed an offence. Last year, the Scottish Government and this Parliament supported the codification of the doctrine for economic crimes in the Economic Crime and Corporate Transparency Act 2023, extending to Scotland. The limitation to economic crimes in the 2023 Act related to the scope of the relevant legislation. Clause 16 of the Criminal Justice Bill, as amended, does not make any changes to the substance of the codification, but rather extends it to all crimes rather than economic crimes only. Clause 27 clarifies which organisations, including Police Scotland, can access the driver data and enables regulations to provide for access to DVLA driver information for all policing or law enforcement purposes. The first supplementary LCM covers the provisions in clauses 1 to 4 of the bill relating to articles used in organised crime and electronic devices for use in vehicle theft. Law enforcement agencies throughout the UK have raised concerns that there are limited legal options to address the rapidly evolving tools and technology exploited by serious criminals. The report that they are increasingly encountering individuals possessing articles where there is a strong suspicion that they are being used for the purposes of serious crime. The measures in the UK Government Bill therefore seek to prohibit the possession of certain specific articles used in serious crime through the introduction of new criminal offences. Currently, the list of articles comprises vehicle concealments, templates to print 3D firearms and pill presses. And I am particularly pleased to see the measure to control access to pill presses. The Scottish Government and many of the key stakeholders, including Police Scotland, have been calling for such measures for some time. The Scottish Government recognises that for the measures in these clauses of the bill to be successful, they should be introduced consistently across the United Kingdom, and therefore we support their introduction. The proposed list of articles will be amendable via secondary legislation to ensure it keeps pace with the evolving threat. The bill therefore also contains a statutory duty for the Secretary of State to consult Scottish ministers before amending the list of articles, regardless of the reserved or devolved status of the article in question. While I'm here, Convener, let me tell you about the further supplementary LCM that will be coming forward very shortly. We had hoped that the amendment would have been tabled in the House of Commons in sufficient time for us to lodge a second supplementary LCM in advance of this committee meeting. The amendment was finally tabled on 9th of May, and we hope that a further supplementary LCM will be lodged in the next week. This further LCM is simply a minor technical amendment to add the new organised crime offences in the supplementary LCM mentioned above to the schedule for the proceeds of organised crime as being indicative of a criminal lifestyle. And I'm sure that committee would wish to support that approach. So thank you, Convener, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Okay, thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary. So I'm just now going to open up to members. So I think Katie Clark, you would like to... No, okay, that's fine. Okay, in that case, do any members have any questions? Russell Finlay.
Yeah, I do. Thank you, Convener. These LCMs relate to the UK Criminal Justice Bill, and there's reference in the submission from Scottish Government about House of Commons debate on the 11th of January of this year. And within that, it says that the Scottish Government rejected clauses 11 and 12 of the UK legislation. Now, these relate to the causing of people to commit online self-harm. And there's been tragic cases of young people harming themselves and even taking their own lives, having been coerced and manipulated by others to do so. But in the transcript of the Hansard debate, it says this was rejected by Scottish Government. And just given the importance, as the submission says, of a consistent UK-wide approach and some of the other matters that have been adopted, can you just explain the thinking behind that particular decision?
Yes, of course, I'm more than happy to, Mr. Findlay. This was a matter that was considered very carefully by the Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport, Ms. Todd. You will appreciate the nature, the wide-ranging nature of the UK Government's Criminal Justice Bill. So while there are many matters that are considered by myself, there are also other matters, specific matters within the bill, that are considered by other colleagues. Can I just say that it is, this matter was given very serious consideration by health colleagues. They will keep it under review, this particular issue, but health colleagues had had considerable engagement on this matter with stakeholders, particularly those stakeholders that are involved in implementing suicide prevention strategies, and there were concerns about unintended consequences, such as potentially criminalising people who were merely trying to give support to people in distress. It is a very complex and sensitive area. But I am advised that health ministers, you know, will be keeping this matter under review. They have concerns right now, but they will, you know, continue to consider matters and see how issues evolve.
Yeah, I mean, the only Scottish MP on that particular committee didn't say anything during that particular debate, as far as I can see, in Hansard. But the UK minister said that the Scottish Government is instead going to, the quote was, sticking with Section 184 of the Online Safety Act for now. So is it the case then that these protections or that legislation, that what that seeks to do, will be instead relied upon using that legislation?
So, yeah, so I mean, there is existing online legislation that we would consider that would be adequate.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions from any members? No? OK, thank you. So can I ask if the committee is content to recommend to the Parliament that consent should be given for the relevant provisions covered by LCM S643 and LCM S643A? Members content? OK, thank you very much. And as the Cabinet Secretary noted, we're aware that there will be further LCMs coming forward that the committee will consider. So are members content to delegate responsibility to myself and the clerks to approve a short factual report to the Parliament on the LCMs? Happy? OK, thank you very much. OK, thank you. So we'll just have a very brief suspension to allow for a changeover of government witnesses. Thank you. Thank you. So our next item of business today is an oral evidence-taking session on an affirmative instrument. That is the International Organisations, Immunities and Privileges Scotland Amendment Order 2024 draft. So we're still joined by the Cabinet Secretary, and I welcome to the meeting Ms. Susan Black, Senior Policy Officer, Civil Law and Legal Systems Unit at the Scottish Government, and Ms Emma Thompson, Solicitor with the Scottish Government Legal Directorate. So welcome. And I refer members to Paper 2. So I intend to allow up to 10 minutes for this evidence session, and can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make some opening remarks on the SSI? Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener, and apologies in advance for any repetition. The draft, the International Organisations Immunities and Privileges Scotland Amendment Order 2024, is an order in Council made by His Majesty under powers in the International Organisations Act 1968. The nature of the reserve devolved divide means that where privileges and immunities relate to devolved matters in Scotland, the function of advising His Majesty in relation to the order is devolved. The purpose of this instrument is to give effect to the obligations relating to immunities and privileges for those matters which are within the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament for two international organisations. Firstly, the European Space Agency, an agreement between the United Kingdom and the European Space Agency concerning the agency's sites and facilities in the United Kingdom, was signed in 2013. The agreement provides for the establishment and operation of an agency centre at Harwell Science and Innovation Campus in Oxfordshire. This order amends the International Organisations Immunities and Privileges Scotland Order 2009 to give full effect to the obligations relating to immunities and privileges under the agreement. The head of the Harwell Centre and seven high-ranking officials who had previously not been protected by the privileges and immunities are now covered to the extent provided for in the agreement. Secondly, the European Organisation for Astronomical Research in the Southern Hemisphere. This order amends Schedule 15 of the 2009 order to reflect the provisions contained within the Protocol on the Privileges and Immunities of the European Organisation for Astronomical Research in the Southern Hemisphere. The privileges and immunities for these two organisations are granted primarily on the basis of strict functional need and importantly contain an exemption to immunity in respect of road traffic accidents. The privileges and immunities are no greater in extent than those required to enable the two organisations and specified individuals connected with the organisations to function effectively. Scotland's space industry and the work of Space Scotland is supported by a number of public sector bodies and agencies, including the European Space Agency. And as committee will be aware, the space industry in Scotland makes an important contribution to Scotland's future economic growth. The space industry contributes in excess of £4 billion to the Scottish economy. The European Space Agency is an important partner, providing support for research and significant funding. Orbex and Skyrora, companies based in Scotland, successfully secured a total of £8.5 million from the agency to develop world-leading small satellite technologies. So this order will ensure that we meet our international obligations and help support the future development of Scotland's space industry. A parallel order has been taken forward by the UK government and is in force for the rest of the UK and for non-devolved Scots law. As a good global citizen, it is the responsibility of the Scottish Government to bring this order to the Parliament for consideration, and I commend it to committee.
Okay, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. So I'll now invite questions from members. Anyone got any questions? Russell Finlay.
Yeah, just perhaps a small point, but in the papers it says that there has been some defective drafting to the order and it should be fixed. It says, sorry, the Scottish Government intends to rectify the earliest opportunity. Now, not so long ago, it was in March, in fact, we had an SSI in front of the committee with the wrong date in it due to another Scottish Government error. The DPLR committee had said that that date should have been corrected. So that may or may not have been done. I don't expect you to know the answer to that. I'm assuming it has been, but it just seems quite, don't want to sound too critical, but quite something that we've had two mistakes in papers coming to us in respect of orders and SSIs that are quite fundamental. Just wondering what your views are on that.
So I appreciate Mr Finlay's irritation in this. The processes around the preparation of these orders are layered upon layers of historical agreements and historical orders. In terms of the original two errors that are either being addressed or will be addressed, my understanding is the error is rooted in the original UK orders, but nonetheless, you know, they will be addressed. It is particularly complex that this is about, you know, the transferring of particular agreements over a number of years into multiple orders that flow from the UK government. But I say that by way of context. I certainly ain't pointing the finger at anyone in this
not
regard.
The last one. Yep.
Sorry?
That's referring to this error.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you.
Any other questions? No? Okay, thank you for that. So our next item of business is to consider a motion to approve the affirmative SSI on which we've just taken oral evidence. So can I remind officials that only MSPs may speak in a debate on the motion? I'm sure you don't need to do that. So can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move motion S6M number 12734 in her name and make any brief additional comments that she would like to make?
It moves, Convener.
Thank you. So do members, I'll just confirm if members have no specific questions or points to raise. Okay, thank you very much. So I'll just invite the Cabinet Secretary to wind up and press or withdraw the motion.
Pressed.
Thank you very much. So the question is that motion S6M number 12734 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary that the International Organisations Immunities and Privileges Scotland Amendment Order 2024 draft be approved. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much. Are members content to delegate responsibility to myself and the clerks to approve a short factual report to the Parliament on the affirmative instrument? Thank you very much. So thank you very much indeed. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for joining us this morning. And we'll just have a brief suspension to allow for a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. Okay, thank you, members. So our next item of business this morning is to consider our Stage 1 evidence-taking on the Police Ethics, Conduct and Scrutiny Scotland Bill. So I welcome to the meeting this morning Michelle McLeod, Police Investigations and Review Commissioner, Mr Philip Chapman, Director of Operations, and Ms Sharon Cleland, Head of Legal Services. So welcome to you all, and thank you very much for providing the committee with your written evidence, which was very comprehensive. And I refer members to papers 3 and 4 and intend to allow up to 90 minutes for this evidence session. So I wonder if I can maybe just kick things off with a question for the Commissioner. And I was interested to note in the written submission that you provided your commentary regarding the duty of candour proposal, and specifically the issue of officers producing an operational statement timeously, which is something that we're aware of can be challenging, so that an investigation can continue without undue delay or as little delay as possible. And a note in your submission, you suggest that an option may be to incorporate a legislative duty to cooperate for police officers and staff that would compel officers and staff to provide an operational statement and attend within a reasonable time for interview. And I think you set out an example of where that's proved to be challenging. So taking into account the right not to self-incriminate, which is something that has come out in our previous evidence session, the duty should only apply to officers and staff whose status has already been confirmed as that of a witness. So that all makes sense. So I'm just interested in hearing a bit more about your views of this particular, or where this particular proposal is coming from. What are the blockages that are creating the issue that you're currently dealing with in terms of timescales? And do you think that compelling someone to produce a statement would work in practice? There's a couple of questions in there, but I'll hand over to you.
Okay, thank you. Well, first of all, I would say that we welcome the duty of candour within the bill. Our position, as you've alluded to, was that we would wish a statutory addition to for a duty to cooperate with interviews, including any investigations being carried out in relation to constables and police staff. And the reason we wish that is to have it on a statutory basis as opposed to part of the policing principles, which and we do welcome the fact that it's specifically included in the policing principles in the provision that is in the draft bill. But we would like it to be enshrined in statute just so there's no dubiety. The issue it would be that whilst it's a policing principle and there is an obligation, therefore, for officers to provide a statement, what would the sanction be if they chose not to in certain circumstances? You're entirely correct that we have recognised that this only applies to officers who we have confirmed their status as a witness. Obviously, if they were subject officers, then that wouldn't be appropriate. And I think the committee may be aware of one case which is currently the matter of a public inquiry where there was a delay in obtaining statements from the officers. What I would say is since that case, we haven't really had an experience where we have had an issue with obtaining statements from officers where we've clarified that they are witnesses. Following that case, there was procedures have been put in place, and there's a memorandum of understanding and guidance whereby it's set out in that memorandum that police officers should cooperate, and if they don't, it can be looked down by the Police Scotland as a conduct issue. So there has been a change since 2015 when that case arose, but we would still prefer that it was a requirement in terms of a statute. There would still be the issue to be considered of what would the sanction be, and that's still an issue that we had raised with the bill team, even if it was in statute. And just the additional request that we had was that it also included police staff, and in that we were particularly thinking about police custody and security officers who have quite often have, well, we do have direct responsibility for persons in custody, and therefore are likely to be witnesses in perhaps deaths in custody investigations, and they have a significant role in looking after the welfare of vulnerable people in the care of the police. So for that reason, we slightly take issue with what they've said in the policy memorandum, that they don't have the same powers and responsibilities as police officers. Given their role in custody matters, we think that that needs to be taken into consideration as well by the Bill team. So, as I say, we welcome the duty, and we welcome the inclusion in the policing principles about the duty to cooperate, which spells out in no uncertain terms that that should happen. Our preference would still be that it was a legislative duty. But I would, as I've said, confirm that we have not had any major difficulties with obtaining statements once we've clarified that the witnesses are, the officers are witnesses. But that's not to say the situation couldn't arise, and what would our remedy be in those circumstances?
Yeah, thanks for that. I mean, is there a kind of, and I'm sure it's a very small chance, but is there a sort of risk, perhaps, where an officer's status could change from being a witness to a suspect? So there's a slight challenge there in terms of duty of candour and obviously compliance with a cooperative approach, if you like.
That can happen in any case that we're investigating. A person may start off as a witness, and as the case proceeds, evidence may come to light that suggests that their version of events is not accurate, or there's or evidence may come that implicates that person. And we keep under review the status of a person throughout an investigation. And if there is evidence that suggests that a person is that we've got concerns that they may become a subject officer and a person that we're looking at from a different perspective, that is something we keep alive through all investigations. So that people do change from witnesses to suspects or accused persons. That happens to members of the public as well. So that is something that at every stage of the investigation, as you gather more evidence, you have to be aware of, because clearly there's when we get to court proceedings, if it came to that, there's issues about admissibility and fairness, etc., that would be taken into in terms of Article 6 rights of the officer or members of the public.
Yeah. Okay, thanks for that clarification. I don't know if either Phil Chapman or Ms Cleland would like to come in on that before we move on, if you'd like to add anything. No? Okay. Okay, thanks for that. I'm interested also in some of the comments that you've made around safeguarding, but I'll come back to that later on, and I will bring in Russell Finlay.
Right, OK. That's fine. I wasn't expecting that. Right. So Section 5 of the Bill talks about the broadening of PERC's functions, and there's a comment from your organisation saying this was significantly impacting PERC's budget and ability to operate. Section 12 of the Bill, the right to call in complaints, again, there's a direct quote that this might result in PERC being, quote, become overwhelmed with further resource implications. Now, we've heard from other witnesses, including the Scottish Police Federation, that the financial cost of the Bill has already risen, according to the financial memorandum, but they believe it will be even higher still. I just wondered what PERC's latest official assessment on the cost has been.
PERC did submit estimates for various provisions to the Bill through our sponsor team to the Bill team. Problem for the difficulty we had in relation to certain provisions is their enabling provisions, and the actual final outcome or the content of those provisions were far from clear, and we're still in that position. So there's some areas, and I think you've alluded to certainly one of them in relation to Section 5, where it's unclear what the breadth and scope of the provisions are going to be, and therefore it puts us in a difficult position to make an estimate of what the implications are financially for us. In terms of Section 5, the misconduct provisions, and one of the things we've sought clarity from the Bill team is that our role will remain in relation only to senior officers and not to rank and file officers. The one The one provision which is being considered, but not yet in the bill, that causes us concern is the idea that we would present the cases. So I'm relaxed about us taking on the preliminary assessment of the case, which currently the SPA do, but probably we then duplicate that process to some extent. So I think we're relaxed about that. We're relaxed, we do the investigation, so that's, there's no change there. And then we make a recommendation about whether we think the conduct reaches the threshold of gross misconduct. So that is something we're familiar and we do, and we've got a small body of officers. So we were not particularly concerned about, hopefully with the body of senior officers are not going to, we're going to have lots of cases from them. So we weren't concerned about that. The one that causes me concern is recommendation 40, which relates to the presenting of cases for two reasons. Firstly, we're an investigatory body, not a prosecutorial body. And I think if we're doing the preliminary assessment, we're then doing the investigation, we're making the decision about gross misconduct, and we're prosecuting the case, or well, not, no, it's not prosecuting, sorry, and we're presenting the case. I don't know where the checks and balances are in that system.
Would you see that removed from the bill?
I would, yes, yeah. We think it should stay with the employer to then commission, right. As it is at the moment, we think it should stay with the police authority.
But if it does happen, it's going to come with a price tag, which we don't know.
Well, we don't know, but what we do know is that officers in these situations always instruct counsel. And for parity, we would presumably have to do that. So what we've said to the Scottish Government is that we would need an undertaking that you would pay for counsel's fees. We would outsource it simply to counsel in these circumstances, and we would seek the recompense to come back. But we don't have many of these cases, fortunately, so we can't have somebody waiting to see if a misconduct case comes up. So we would always probably have to outsource it. So that's where we are. But I think there's a more fundamental about the checks and balances. People have asked about perks accountability in other areas, but here we're getting to make all the decisions and we're presenting the case. So I think there's a bit of an issue there for me of checks and balances.
Now, one of the non-legislative recommendations of Angelini was that perks should investigate all on-duty allegations of assault made against police, yes, officers. And since October 2021, that's been happening,
yes,
and has caused a significant impact in your workload. Can you perhaps quantify what that has meant for the organisation in terms of numbers of,
yes,
typical numbers of cases, or what that means as a proportion of your workload?
Yes, I can. I'm just trying to find the figures. So headline figures I can provide, and I can find further details. In 2021, PERC had 544 referrals, and 78 of those went to investigation. In 23-24 last year, we had 834 referrals, so that was an increase of 53%.
These are all assaults?
No.
These are
all our investigation referrals, but the bulk of them are assaults.
Right.
And 151 of those, that's a 93% increase, went to investigation. So we've gone from 78 to 151 in that period of time. And primarily they are Article 3 assault cases.
Right. Okay. Now, in 2018, your predecessor, Kate Frame, raised concerns about the case of an innocent man who'd been wrongly locked up after the police failed to check his identity. And Police Scotland recorded this as a quality of service complaint. And in a letter to this committee before my time here, Ms Frame said that Police Scotland's handling of this case suggests an endeavour to keep matters hidden. And other witnesses have told us about serious alleged crimes being kept in-house by Police Scotland, not shared with Crown or PERC. And many of these same people have, I'm sure you've heard their evidence, have absolutely no faith in PERC in respect of their complaints. Do you think that Police Scotland, since those days, can now be trusted to fully disclose such cases as they should?
I think first of all, I'd say that case came to light because of PERC and because of a complaint handling review, which raised the concerns that led it to turn to a criminal investigation and was reported to Crown Office. So it was PERC that actually identified that through a complaint handling review process. And where I would say there is more safeguards than there was at that time is that PERC now undertake audits by the review and policy team undertake audits of Police Scotland's complaint handling. So we had an audit of the triage system in 22, which was reported. It looked at categorisation by Police Scotland. It was looking at how they'd categorise cases and whether that was the correct category. Was it quality of service? Was it an irregularity in procedure? So there is a check and balance. There is more checks by PIRC through our audit process to look at the category that police have allocated to a particular case. Police now have an obligation to report all allegations of assault and unlawful detention, Article 3 and Article 5, to PIRC. They don't have a discretion in relation to that. And obviously, one mechanism that a person can, if they feel they're aggrieved, is through our complaint handling review, come in there and sometimes they come in and we can't look at them because we did deem them to be criminal, and we will go back to Police Scotland and ask that is made into an allegation of criminality and referred to us. So there is more, I think, rigour about ensuring that such matters are looked at.
There was another case subsequent to that one in which a female police officer from the Moray area made multiple internal allegations
of
employment nature and of a criminal nature. And these were kept in-house, withheld from the relevant authorities. She has also been publicly very critical of PIRC. But on the one hand, PIRC unblocked that case by identifying and investigating those allegations, which up until then had not been. But the subsequent report into the entire case has not been published. Can you explain why that would be?
I'm aware of the case, and my understanding is PIRC did investigate that as a criminal case. Yep. We had a number of allegations that were investigated from the investigation side of our house rather than the complaint side, and that was all reported to Crown Office. And the reason it's not published is our reports to Crown Office can't be published. They are confidential to the Crown. The Crown then consider whether there is, in relation to any of the allegations, sufficient evidence, and then we'll decide whether to instruct a prosecution or not. So it's, we provide all of the evidence to the Crown, and it's not something we've got the ability or we're not able to put that into the public domain because it's like any other criminal investigation, it's confidential.
You as the PIRC, mm-hmm. I don't want to put words in your mouth, are you now confident that if similar cases arose now or in the future, Police Scotland would treat them properly?
I'm more confident that we have really, since the original Dame Eilish report, the levels of communication liaison are in a different sphere than they were then. We have all layers of ranks, etc. Director of Appropriations has almost weekly dialogue with the head of PSD, and we find that they are very accessible and much more open than I think was probably in my prior to my time. So I think I'm in a better place. I don't think I'm in a position to ever say 100% that I've got there's something that I don't know, that we know everything. I'm not in a position to say that, but I think we're in a far better place than we have been previously.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Rona Mackay, then Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. I'd like to ask Philip Chapman first, please. The time taken to complete investigations and the lack of transparency in the system have come across to us from witnesses. One witness said the system doesn't work for police officers or for members of the public. Do you think that the bill does enough to address the issues of lengthy timescales and those problems? And maybe you could explain a wee bit around that and if you think things are going to improve, because that was a definite problem that we were hearing.
Yeah, thank you for your question. Probably take it in two parts. So internally within the organisation, we recognise on the back of the recommendations made by Dame Eilish of a need to categorise and give more precedence to investigations where there was a death, families next of kin who obviously expected an answer to their questions quickly, recognising that the resource that we've got covers all the various aspects of categorisation, whether it's criminal investigations, referrals from the police. We carried out a performance data review 2 years ago. That's allowed us to look right across organisational functions and identify what the pinch points were. We've now got a system in place whereby for our Category A cases, which invariably involve a death or a significant incident, those cases are, from the point that they're received by the park, assessed and then put to investigation, we report them within 90 working days. That for us is across the UK in policing oversight terms hugely challenging to meet these deadlines. In the last year, all our cases that we've had at Category A, we've reported to the Crown or back to the policing body that's referred to us for a Category A in that period of time. So we've got 100% compliance in that regard. In relation to the other cases, Category B, which are usually police referrals involving serious incidents, and Category C, which is a criminal allegation, higher volume, less serious cases, we've got timescales of 120 working days that they have to be reported, which essentially for us, we're meeting that targets. We're sitting around about 85% for those figures. So for us internally, we've taken cognizance of Dame Eilish's recommendations in terms of the non-legislative part and trying to reshape how we are going to progress matters. We understand victims' distress. We've got systems and practices in place in terms of family liaison officers when there's families next of kin that need to be kept up to date. We recognise that the Crown ultimately direct our investigations, particularly in relation to deaths. But we've got very good liaison, as the Commissioner spoke about, in terms of monthly meetings now between ourselves, the Scottish Fatalities Unit, the head of CAPD for criminal matters, all within the Crown Office, where if there are specific cases where families feel that there are contentious issues or they wish to make representations, then we can discuss them earlier so they can get a swifter remedy to getting answers to their questions ultimately.
So your workload has increased considerably since the Angelina. So did you take on more staff to deal with that?
I think in terms of overall, since we've taken on the responsibility for the Article 3, which was in October of 2021, I think 9 staff are thereby in terms of full-time equivalent that we've taken on to take on that challenge. We've now, as of the 1st of April this year, the Crown have issued a statutory instruction to the police to refer all matters of Article 5, which relates to unlawful detention. So they will now start coming to us as well. More likely that we won't see such a significant increase because they're very few and far between. But that's obviously there, and we need to keep a withering eye on that just to make sure that it doesn't have a disproportionate effect on the workload.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for that. Can I ask Sharon Cleland, please? Good morning. I want to ask you about non-disclosure agreements and whether they are routinely used in your work.
Well, in terms of PERC, we haven't had a case where we've had to use a non-disclosure agreement. Whether there are any used between a policing body and their staff is obviously it's a private matter in terms of the resolution of a civil claim in the employment tribunal. So it's not really something that we would have any input into.
That's fine. I just wondered about that. Just very one more quick. Thank you. So I wanted to ask you about the HMICS. And HMICS already has a responsibility for reviewing the policies and practice of Police Scotland and the SPA. And to coordinate that with the PERC. Do you think that whole arrangement's working well? Does anything else needs to be done legislatively to improve that?
We have, we have regular meetings with all the inspector bodies, including HMICS, I have regular contact with the Chief Inspector. In terms of policies and practices, the provision in the draft bill is something that we agree with, but I do recognise that in terms of doing thematic reviews, inspections and audits, the primacy lies with HMICS, and I've made that clear. Where I would say that we could add some value is HMICS is a relatively small team with limited capacity. They have quite a full programme, and sometimes they're asked to do work at a short notice by the Cabinet Secretary if something is high profile. So they tend to be very strategic, so they'll look at culture, they'll look at diversity, they'll look at other organisational issues such as vetting, which I've done a recent inspection on. The areas where we have identified, mainly through the complaint handling side, we will see repeat complaints come in about certain areas, operational areas they tend to be. At the moment, we can do two things. We can raise it with Police Scotland and say, we're seeing a lot of complaints about this particular area. Can you go and have a look at your policies and see if they need to be updated or revised, etc.? So we can do that, and we do that, and Police Scotland are receptive to feedback from ourselves. Or we can say to HMICS, there's something here that I think you may wish to have a look at. And I've done that certainly with the previous chief inspector. But again, capacity sometimes doesn't means that they're not able to address it. And without this power, I cannot do anything in relation to it in a thematic or holistic way, which will be probably more beneficial than just looking at one complaint and answering and making recommendations about one complaint. So I think there was cases in the past about execution of warrants and the system of that I would have, if I had had this power then, would have probably said, I think we'll go and have a look at how policing are doing that, how they're categorising their warrants, what are their policies, procedures, and let's have a review of that. Another area is dealing with the difficult area where police officers have to break devastating news to families, and quite a few of our complaints arise because of maybe they feel it was insensitively done or the initial interaction was poor. Again, we've had quite a number of those, because I see the most serious, the Category A complaints, and they're about deaths mainly. So there's an area there you think, is the training right? Have they got the right people doing it? So those are the kind of areas I think we could add some value. We wouldn't have the resource to do many of these, but we've now built up some skills in the reviews team by doing our audits into the complaint handling. So there's scope there to maybe say, the other thing, our Centurion system has been upgraded to allow us now to actually put in keywords and identify common complaints. So if we see something that's coming up over and over, we can go and look and see what are the issues. Can it be solved easily by speaking with the police? Or is it something we could add a bit of benefit and learning by doing the review? Okay. So whilst I appreciate HMICS, this is their field and their territory and they're experts in this, we would always go to them first and say, have you got capacity to do this? Do you want to do it? If not, then obviously I think the legislation suggests that we go and speak to the Chief Constable and say we'd like to do something in this area. So we're supplementing it.
Very briefly, what is the SPA's role in it? Do you have much interaction with them? Where do they fit into the picture?
We do have interaction with the SPA. And in fact, ask Phil to speak about the CCC.
Thank you.
Yeah. So the Scottish Police Authority have the Complaints and Conduct Committee, which previously they hold the police to account in terms of how they're actually dealing with them. We've now been invited onto their committee to present to their committee and then provide dialogue in terms of the recommendations and the thematic topics that we're identifying. That's a quarterly meeting. The head of reviews, the head of investigations for the park both attend that meeting and give presentations. It gives us the ability to feed into the committee anything that we feel are topics that keep coming up in terms of complaint handlings or investigations. And it then allows for them to really drill into the detail with the seniors within PSD to make sure that they've got a clear oversight of everything that's ongoing. Because just because it comes to the park, ultimately the complaint was still handled by the police originally. So by us saying how many complaints that we're dealing with are reasonably handled, how many are not, and what the recommendations and thematic topics are, then allows them to scrutinise how the police are responding to the recommendations.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. Thanks, Convener.
I wonder if I can maybe just come in with a supplementary, just when we're discussing policy and practice and procedures. So in some of the evidence that we've previously heard from witnesses with lived experience, we heard from one witness in relation to the provision of family liaison officers, and we heard that her particular family had not been given support by a family liaison officer, and it was in the circumstances of an unexplained death. You're probably aware of the case. Certainly I find it quite distressing to hear that. So in terms of, you've spoken about perhaps highlighting issues to Police Scotland around good practice and perhaps issues that you're seeing starting to emerge. Is that the type of thing that I've just set out that you would have a locus in perhaps flagging, or would that be more of HMICS perhaps?
I mean, If the provision is implemented, it could be either. As I say, I would always give primacy to HMICS. But I mean, if there was particular, we were seeing a lot of correspondence from complainers coming in, and an issue was about the lack of a flow being appointed at the right time, or we've had ones where the relationship between the flow and the person hasn't worked out very well. So if there was issues about flows generally, then it may be something that we could use this provision to look at in more detail. I think one of the issues in relation to the complaint handling review is, I think sometimes people have unrealistic expectations of what it can actually do. The purpose of a review is to determine whether or not the complaint was handled to a reasonable standard. So doing that, the team will look at, did the police response address the crux of the complaint? Did the rationale that it was upheld or not upheld, was that based on evidence? Was it, and did it take account of practices and policies? And did they, in some cases, apply the right test? And we will then decide if we felt it was dealt with to a reasonable standard or not. And if we believe it wasn't, then we can make recommendations to the police and say, could you go and reassess this complaint? Could you go and interview these officers? There's parts of the complaint which are deficient, and can you go and address that? And at the moment, the bill would provide us with some more teeth in relation to those recommendations. At the moment, we've got no sanction if the police choose not to implement the recommendations. I would say that in most cases, we work well with the police, and they do. And we can identify learning points. But I think there's an expectation sometimes on people that come to us that we can actually investigate the substance of the complaint, and we can maybe direct the police to take out further investigations. Mm-hmm. And that's not what we can do in the complaint handling sphere. So sometimes, even when we find in favour of the applicant and say it wasn't handled reasonably and we make recommendations, they're still disappointed because the expectation and our form asks, what are you expecting, is sometimes that the investigation is recommenced, and we have no powers to do that. So we have to try and manage those expectations at the very outset. But in relation to identifying common themes from the complaints, then some of the provisions in this Act would give us more scope to go and look at that, and maybe provide a more reassurance to the person that it's not, maybe not just about their complaint, but we'll look at it and we'll see if we can change procedures for in a policy that applies to more complainers. We actually had one recently where the police have changed their domestic abuse protocol in response to a complaint that we had that didn't take account of risk factors. I won't go into the details of it, but it actually came through our investigation site, and the police have now changed and added something in. So we can do it on an ad hoc basis, but obviously having a power to look at it more systematically and holistically would be preferable.
Yeah, thank you for that. Okay, I'll bring in Sharon Dowie, then Fulton McGregor.
Thank you. Good morning. The communication with the police seems to have improved a wee bit for the comments that you've said so far and the evidence. The bit I was going to look at in section 9-16. It refers to functions of the PIRC, and it says it will provide the PIRC with additional powers, including extra functions in the complaint handling review process, being able to call in complaints, review practices and policies of Police Scotland and the SPA. Last week, we heard evidence from the Federation, and David Kennedy had said, "My point is that the current regulations are not used as they should be. That is why we say that the bill is not needed if they are used properly. When the misconduct regulations were released, we also had the performance regulations. They have never been used." Seeing your communication with Police Scotland, are you finding that when you're doing your investigations? Are there regulations or policies and procedures there just now that are not being used? Is it something you've come across?
the conduct regulations, we only deal with conduct for senior officers, so we're not dealing with rank and file conduct issues. So in terms of that level of regulations, I wouldn't be cited on the issues that arise there, because, as I say, we only deal with misconduct for senior officers. So I think because I'm not dealing day to day with the conduct regulations, I wouldn't be able to comment, I think, informatively on that. I don't know if anything to add to that.
Yeah, I mean, we essentially, if it's a criminal matter, we come at the start of the investigation, we'll report the circumstances to the Crown, and then after the Crown makes a decision not to proceed, then the case will go back to PSD to then commence their misconduct, if you like. But we don't communicate directly with the police in these matters, because we have to report it to the Crown. The Crown also quite regularly will write to the police and express a view in terms of they'll disclose cases when they're asked to allow the police then to carry on in the public interest, if you like, with their misconduct handling. But we don't get involved, as the Commissioner says, in rank and file and David Kennedy and the members that he represents.
So you've not come across anything like that when you've done investigations? Okay. We've also heard evidence in an illustration that the Police Scotland's Professional Standards Department should not carry out preliminary assessments of complaints against officers because it's not independent. Do you think that PIRC, if it was given sufficient resources, would be in a better place to carry out these assessments to avoid any perceived or actual bias?
My position is that I'm comfortable PIRC dealing with conduct in relation to senior officers, but our role is really to look at the criminality aspect and to deal with driving up standards and complaints handling. We do not have a general role in relation to conduct proceedings for rank and file officers. I think that's a matter between the SPA and Police Scotland, and for them to decide how to improve the situation.
Okay. Going back to sections 48, the bill, the cover aspects of police conduct again. It allows the function to be conferred in the PIRC to be amended. It's an enabling power only, and details of these functions are not provided in the bill. It provides a power to allow gross misconduct procedures to be applied to former police officers. Again, further details provided in secondary legislation. And it amends the misconduct procedures for senior police officers, again, to be provided through secondary legislation. Does it concern you that more details are not provided in the face of the bill? Do you have any concerns about that at all?
Yes, I think I alluded to when I was asked about financial implications that obviously greater clarity on the provisions would allow us to be more able to estimate of the impact financially and in terms of resources. In relation to misconduct for senior officers, I understand the rationale behind conduct matters to continue after someone's retired, in the same way that the bill allows us would allow us to look at criminality after a person had retired. And I understand the public concern about that and the rationale behind that. But I'm happy that there's safeguards put in that in relation to the senior officers, that PIRC would look at proportionality in that situation and would take that into account before we carried on a gross misconduct investigation into an officer who had since left the service. In the criminality, and I think Mr Farrell from CAPD is due to give evidence, one of the frustrations, I think, on the Crown and to some extent to PIRC is that currently, if there's an allegation of criminality, and we're investigating it and an officer retires, resigns, we can no longer investigate that. So Crown Office then have to ask Police Scotland to investigate that officer's conduct, while we could be in parallel investigating officers who are still within the force out of the same set of circumstances. And so we've got parallel investigations ongoing into the same set of circumstances, which clearly is undesirable, and it's almost a duplication of resources. So I know that the Crown have been very supportive of clarifying that position and allowing PIRC to carry on even if a person retires or resigns in relation to the criminal allegations and to do criminal investigations. So that will take a bit of the kind of difficulty that exists at the moment, when these circumstances of the officers change. And some cases come to us and they've already left, so we don't start the investigation. But some were actually started and we have to then pass it back. So it's quite a difficult process. So we're supportive of that because it gives clarity and it's simpler and it's more straightforward. But it will involve more investigations for us and it will involve more resources. But we're unable to quantify that because we cannot work out who is going to resign and how many investigations. But we do know, because we've had a lot of cases, I can't quantify it as a lot, but we've had certainly several cases where we've had to say to Crown, sorry, we can't look at this anymore, the officer's left. So that would give that will make the system more streamlined. And I think, I suspect that Mr. Farrell is supportive of that, because it's quite frustrating for Crown to have the report coming from two bodies into the same incident.
So will that be a substantial increase in resources that are required from you, or is it just going to move it from the finances from one body to another body?
At the moment, the ones that are ongoing, people leave, probably don't really impact because we're already investigating this situation. It's when there's a criminal allegation and the Crown cannot refer it to us because the person's left, so we don't see them at all at the moment. But we know they're there. We just don't know how many of them are there and how many we're likely to get. So it's a bit of it's unquantifiable. But what we would do if this comes in is obviously we will start to quantify that. And one of the things we can do, and we do is regularly discuss with our sponsor team that our workload's going up. We need more resources. And we'd speak to the sponsor team and would obviously put in a business case, etc., as we've done with the Article 3. And we've done over successive increases in our responsibilities, but it's a difficult one because we don't know how many cases there are until they actually come to us.
Okay. One of the previous witnesses told the committee that Police Scotland took 1 year to investigate a complaint and that PIRC then took the best part of a year to review it. Is there a target that PIRC aims to meet when reviewing complaints made against officers from members of the public?
Yes, there is. Mr. Chapman referred to our performance targets in relation to investigations, and we have that also for reviews, which was part of the same a review that we completed last year. In terms of a Category A for CHR, 90 days, it's 90 days for a category, and that's the most serious, so that's obviously where death is involved or serious aspects of criminality. We, in the reviews side, I completely, I'm being candid, there was a backlog when I took up the post, and it has taken some time to erode that backlog, but I'm pleased to say we're in a really good position in relation to that, and this year we've met the targets. I think probably the first time since I've been in post we've met them, and we have got stability in the team. The team has gone through a period of flux over the period I've been there, and needed probably additional resource when I came in. I think that was identified in Dame Ilitch's original report, and we did that. COVID impacted quite a lot on the backlog we had as well in complaints side, but I'm pleased to say things have moved on, and certainly we are meeting the time scales now, and that's the target that we're aiming for. There are some cases, there's some complaints that have got numerous heads, up to 80 complaints that have got copious documentation that we have to get from Police Scotland. That takes a long time to read through, to understand, that will take longer. And we have now provision for what we call a Category A-plus case, both in investigations and in reviews, to say to people, to manage their expectations, we are not going to be able to do this in this period of time. We will keep you updated, and we'll come back to you at regular timescales or whatever you want to let you know how we're doing. There's some cases that just are... You know, particularly historic cases that are maybe dealing with serious criminality, murder, etc. So, but in general, I think we're in a better place. I do accept that in the past that hasn't been always the case.
Mm-hmm. There were suggestions that the police were reluctant to give information, but from what you've said earlier on, it seems that that seems to have improved, the relationship seems to have improved, but the bill intends to give Perth access to the police's electronic database relating to complaints. So will this help?
Yes. I mean,
speed up more?
Yeah, the police have always accepted that they have never opposed or disagreed with that recommendation. The difficulty is the technology that PIRC and Police Scotland are not at the same level in Centurion. So there's been upgrades. We've had upgrades that we've put in, and Police Scotland are currently, I think, putting in upgrades. And once we're kind of at the same level, that should be... It's a technical issue that we can resolve. In the background, we're working on information sharing protocols because obviously we should only get access to what we are entitled legally to get access. We understand that. We understand people's data protection concerns. But if we do get that access direct, at the moment we've improved the system. We get it through egress and we've got a much slicker transfer of information from Police Scotland to ourselves in the last probably 12 months. But if we get access... We give the police 15 days from us to saying we would like you to give us the information for us to deal with this complaint. If we get it, we can go straight in. That takes 15 days off the process. So once we have got that up and running, that will help with time skills, I would, considerably.
One quick.
I can come back to you. I'll bring in other members and come back to you. I'll bring in Fulton McGregor, then Pauline McNeill.
Hey, thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. I was actually going to be asking questions in the same area as Sharon Dowie, but I think she's covered quite a lot there and quite a lot of good responses. So I'll ask it in another area. It's just a very general question, probably for yourself, Michelle McLeod. I'm wondering if you feel that the provisions are in place to ensure that, you know, that there's adequate and timely responses from organisations when you as a PIRC make recommendations?
So the recommendations, as I've alluded to, we don't have any statutory basis to if the organisation or Police Scotland or any of the policing bodies that we have oversight decide that they choose not to do that. We do, though, monitor the progress of the recommendations. The reviews team has a record of the timeliness of them, and they have a period, police have a time period to get back to us in, and we do chase them up quite regularly if they don't come back to us in the time period. So we do have more information on that than we've ever had, actually. And I think it's very important to show where PIRC is adding value to the process, and one of the areas is to identify that learning and make sure it's cascaded and implemented. So the recommendations are very important, and that's why we've put greater focus in the last probably 18 months on making sure we record what they've done, when they've done it, and what's outstanding. So we do have that. Obviously, if we go forward with the provisions, it's an obligation on the police to do it unless there's operationals not to do it and they have to explain. That puts a much more kind of, gives us a bit of teeth, because sometimes I think people say, you know, if you haven't got the power to enforce them, then what's the point? But my experience is that generally police are very cooperative and are willing to take on board our recommendations. And if they don't accept them for any reason, then we're happy to have a discussion to say, well, we've identified this problem. If you're not going to do it this way, how are you going to sort it? We just want the problem sorted, and we'll have that discussion with them. But yeah, give us some more teeth if that recommendation is part of the bill.
Well, that's what I was going to ask you about. Do you think you need that teeth or that extra clout, whatever way you want to put it? Is that something you'd be?
I think from a public perception, we have to sometimes write to complainers and they'll say what's happened to the recommendation. We'll say, well, we've chased police up, but you know, we haven't got any power to enforce it in a particular time scale, or we probably don't put it in that terms to the complainer, but we have to explain that, you know, we're at the kind of bequest of Police Scotland as to when it might happen, but we will continue to chase it. So I think then complainers, not unsurprisingly, get frustrated and say, well, where's your power to actually, you said you were going to get the police to do this and you haven't done anything. So it would be helpful If there was a mechanism then to sort of say to police, look, this is an important recommendation here. I really would like to have this explanation of why you haven't actually implemented it addressed it. So I think it would be, but I'm not saying that we have a good relationship. And in most cases, particularly if we've identified a serious deficiency, we find that they're receptive to taking on board our comments and recommendations.
OK, thanks. There's a final question I also wanted to ask you about support for whistleblowers. I know that you have said that you don't feel that it's necessary for the PIP to be added to the list of prescribed organisations in the public interest disclosure as recommended by the Angelini Review. Just wondering if you can expand on your thinking around that a wee bit.
Could I maybe ask?
Yep. Sorry, I'll take that one and thank you. Lady Angelini did say in the report that the two things were recommended, and one was adding PIRC to the prescribed persons list and also the audit function. And I think what we've said in our response is we're supportive of the audit function and that ability to be able to review and report on and make recommendations about how Police Scotland are actually putting in place steps to handle whistleblowers and to handle complaints and make sure that they are triaged and handled and responded to appropriately. What she did say in the report was that persons should have the ability, where they don't feel they can make that protected disclosure to their employer, to make it to another prescribed person, and noted that for policing there wasn't one in Scotland, which we don't necessarily agree with. There's a list already of prescribed persons, which include from the Lord Advocate to the Scottish Information Commissioner to ICO to IPCO. And what the current guidance and what the current code of practice for whistleblowing in the UK says, if you are going to make a protected disclosure to a prescribed person, so not to your employer, then it has to be to the relevant prescribed person. So in our view, the things that whistleblowers may be coming to us to make protected disclosures about, there are already a number of prescribed persons on that list who are the relevant and correct people. So they would be coming to PIRC, and essentially we would be acting as a postbox and putting those protected disclosures on. There's also, I think, concern for us in terms of providing the employment protection to officers or staff who make protected disclosures. And we're not in a position to do that. So if people are looking not to suffer detriment for making a protected disclosure, such as officers who don't want to be moved post, we don't necessarily have the ability to ensure that those protections are provided. And the point of the recommendations is to build the trust and the confidence in people being able to make protected disclosures. And in our view, the best way to do that is to have that audit function in the same way we do for complaint handling processes and be able to assess how they're being dealt with by Police Scotland as the employer and ensure that there's confidence that can be built there in how it's been dealt with. So in our view, the audit function actually does what's needed and provides that, as Commissioner said, provides the value in that space.
Okay. That's actually really helpful. Thank you.
Yep. Thank you. Pauline McNeill.
Good morning. I confess I'm still trying to get my head around how it all works, so forgive me if I get some things wrong. The first question I wanted to ask was about your role in relation to allegations of criminality against police officers. Now, I'm familiar with a number of cases where it's taken up to 2 years or longer, and in some cases where there's been that officers have been found not guilty and then face further proceedings from Police Scotland in relation to the conduct aspect of it. It just seems to me to be grossly unfair either way that it takes this length of time. Now, you'll find many organisations will say the same, but these police officers, I think, are suspended during that period, so they don't even get the benefit. Police Scotland doesn't get the benefit of having the officers until it's completed. So I wanted to understand the role of PIRC in relation to, I know the more common one would be assaults against prisoners, for example. Could you help me with that one? Thank you.
Yes, indeed. We've alluded to it earlier. So any Crown can ask us to investigate criminality of any police officers, but just the main ones come to us are primarily, as we've discussed, assaults. And we've explained that we aim to have that report to the Crown Office within 90 days in the most serious cases. So, and we are meeting that target. Thereafter, it's a matter for Crown, obviously, to determine whether they think there's sufficient evidence, whether they think it's in the public interest, whether they think it's a matter that could be dealt with by conduct and decide not to proceed to a prosecution. It's more in the public interest to do that. And again, that falls to Crown. So once it's out of our hands, mm-hmm. it's with the Crown. In some of these cases, the Crown will... We've had a number of significant investigations in the last couple of years, and the Crown have asked us to carry out further inquiries, and they've come back. Just as they would do with a police force, with any investigation, they come back and say, could you do further work on this? So there's some cases where... they are very serious offences, and we are doing a lot of work in the background for Crown, and they will eventually make a decision whether there's sufficient evidence, and, as I say, to prosecute, and it's in the public interest. I know that, as I say, Mr Farrell, who's the head of CAPD, is attending, and mm-hmm. I've read his submission, I should say I was a prosecutor for 21 years before I became this post and previous posts. So I'm aware of dealing with allegations of criminality from the Crown aspect, and I'm aware of the concerns of policing that sometimes the length of time it takes. Certainly the inspectorate report from the prosecution inspectorate, from my recollection that they did, I think, about 18 months ago, showed that there was a change, and that the cases were being dealt with more quickly, and certainly the submission that has been given to the committee from CAPD suggests that they are meeting their targets of, I think, making decisions within 6 months. Hopefully I haven't got that wrong, in 95% of the cases. So I would like to think that it was taking a long time, I'm aware of that, but I think things have changed, and there has been more rapid turnaround on these cases. And I've heard, even speaking to police officers, that's not been an issue that's been as prevalent as when I first took up posts about the time. And I totally understand that. You've got an allegation hanging over you, and many of the matter of whether they go on restricted duties or suspended is entirely for their employer, Police Scotland. So I know that happens, and I can imagine the frustration, but we are aiming to get these cases to Crown as quickly as we can, and to assist Crown to make decisions if they need us to do further work. So I think there's improvements in that area. That's my understanding, and hopefully Mr Farrell will be able to confirm the timescales to do it. But we do appreciate the knock-on effect to basically the public not having those officers available, the officers themselves, just as any member of public who's got an allegation hanging over them. So we are conscious. Some investigations, however, we've had, as I say, a number of very extensive, the incident in Skye. We had four different investigations into that, and there was a lot of follow-up work required by the Crown. So some of them just take a lot of time to get it right, basically. But we are trying to make sure that they are dealt with as expeditiously as possible.
Thank you. So that's good to know that you're meeting the targets of 90 days. So that means that Park are doing quite a lot of the work then in preparing the report for Crown. Is that fair to say that?
Yes. I'll right. agree with that.
Okay. So I know where my next panel's going then to find out what happens after those 90 days. Thank you. You say in your submission that there should be distinction drawn while an officer still holds office over the allegations subsequent to the officer holding the office of constable, and after, so an allegation comes after they're no longer with the police. Does that mean that you think there's some adjustment needing done to the bill in order to reflect that?
I think that goes back to my previous comments about the inefficiency at the moment of us not being able to carry on a criminal investigation if somebody leaves the force, and that having to then go to Police Scotland to carry on the investigation, and us carrying on an investigation maybe into the same incident with people who have not left. So it goes to that inefficiency in the system.
Right.
And so that provision will rectify that and allow, if an officer leaves, the Park can continue to investigate that and report it to the Crown. So that will help again with timescales, because obviously if we're halfway through, it has to go to Police Scotland to start again, then that adds delay on. So that will actually help with reducing the timescales.
And there's a 12-month period after the allegation that it should be dealt with, except in exceptional circumstances, if it's what's the word, not appropriate to do so, if it's proportionate to do so, is that right?
I think that might be in the conduct, is that? The conduct,
right.
That's the conduct space that they've got that time period. And again, for senior officers, yes, as I understand it, there's some safeguards there that if the allegations come to light after a certain period. But I think it's also to look at the proportionality and the public interest, because clearly if an officer has left, there's a substantial public money involved in taking an investigation, to a hearing when the officers left. You'd have to look and see to some extent what's going to be the outcome of that. So that's all quite new territory that we would probably have to feel our way through and test as it comes in. But I think there needs to be probably, I agree that there needs to be some kind of safeguards in there for all officers in relation to how far we can continue to investigate matters of conduct.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with you, because it seems to me to be a bit unfair if you just retired, your natural retirement, you're not going on early retirement, and then a year afterwards along comes an allegation that you weren't aware of. So would you agree that has to be quite a high test then?
I think it is framed in the bill as quite a high test. Okay. And as I say, we're dealing with the senior officers, so it's a high threshold, and we would take account of many of the circumstances. Obviously, the more serious the allegation, if it dealt with vulnerability of witnesses, if we're in sort of a sphere of, you know, real public concern, that places the onus that you're more likely to go ahead with it. But if it's, you know, a less serious allegation, then you would take that into account. So it's an assessment we would do in when we're weighing up the public interest.
Thank you. That's helpful. In your paper, you also see the Angelini report is silent on who decides on gross misconduct. So currently, it's the Deputy Chief Constable designate under the current regulations. Can you speak to that point?
I think, again, as I alluded to, we don't have any involvement with rank and file conduct matters and those regulations. So they are, I think, the Deputy Chief Constable's remit. Ours is restricted to the senior officers, and the referral for that comes from the SPA to us. So I can't really speak to, I can't really assist you on that point.
If I've read it correctly, So I think what you're saying is really shouldn't be any change to the current arrangements then. It's therefore in Congress to suggest in order to allow proceedings to continue, respect an officer resigns in advance of any gross misconduct hearings. And then you talk about usurping the powers of the Chief Constable. So my understanding is there's a matter, but Angeline doesn't say anything about that.
I think, I'll be corrected if I'm wrong, I think this was when the bill was introduced, we were very concerned that there was just reference to constables and it didn't clarify our role was only in relation to senior officers. So in our consultation, we made commentary about that. I think it's been clarified to us since then by the bill team that it is only senior officers, but our anxiety was we were suddenly going to be involved in the rank and file conduct. So that was our concern. So I think it's been overtaken and superseded. So apologies, I had forgotten to put that
in. That's helpful, thank you. I mean, just lastly, in relation to public complaints against the police, at one specific area I was interested in is, when I did mention this in the last session, just as an example, of where there's poor investigatory processes within a police investigation, such as the Emma Caldwell case, where, OK, 20 years on, we can look back and see, well, they follow the lines of inquiry that don't really seem to stand up. Are there processes currently or within this bill that allow, say, a family to complain about the quality of investigation, or is that not something that's really catered for?
I think the one provision that may address that is the call-in provision in Section 12, where I think Lady Angelini envisaged that could be used in cases where, whether through a complaint handling review or other ways, that PIRC identified that something had been handled so inadequately or badly that they took over. It's the complaint, and I would... it's a complaint rather than the investigation, and I would make that distinction again. From I don't want to raise expectations because it's Section 12 relates to non-criminal complaints, and the reason for that clearly is criminality is it's accountable to the Lord Advocate, and so PIRC cannot really be reviewing a case where it's a matter for the Lord Advocate. So it's non-criminal. So it would allow a complaint that had been dealt with really badly would allow us, or me, in the public interest to say to the Chief Constable, I'm going to take this over and investigate it right from the start. So it's one exception. I said earlier, a complaint handling review, we can't investigate, we can't instruct the police to investigate, and we can't actually investigate the substance, but call in complaint would allow us to investigate the substance. So that would give an opportunity for a family or a complainer to come and say, this has been so hopeless, can you just take this over? Now, this is the one where I think there was reference to us being overwhelmed. There's a lot of aggrieved people that are unhappy with outcomes of various cases. And we were concerned that we are going to spend a lot of time doing assessments of all of these to see if they fit into the public interest criteria. And we have made, we have said to the Scottish Government, to the Bill team, this could cost us a substantial amount of time and resourcing. And we have said that we probably have a standalone team that would look into this, because I suspect we will get a lot of people looking for us to take over a complaint. So I think there's a couple of things that I would just urge caution that it's not about criminality, first of all, so we can't be in that. So we're in the non-criminal area, but there may be some areas of public interest that we can actually go in and actually take over the investigation of the complaint, which may give more reassurance to family members. But that would be certainly new work, and there could be a lot of us looking at assessing to see whether it fitted into the criteria. Mm-hmm. So that's a very new provision again that we would have to feel our way through and work through. But it is one that would probably be quite different, us taking over from anything we do at the moment.
Yeah, I can see how tricky that might be. And do you think that there maybe are other checks and balances in the system now that would prevent an investigation that is going down completely the wrong path for so long? Do you think there might be?
I mean, I can only speak to investigations, obviously, dealing with police officers. Mm. So, one option to the Crown is now for PIRC to look at all of those kind of allegations. But in relation to general criminality, that would probably be something that Police Scotland and Crown would be able to assist you with more.
Mm-hmm. Perhaps it's more a whistleblowing issue, I suppose. I'm just interested in it because when you're thinking about legislation, you want to make sure that the actual problems are captured by something as big as this and that, okay, that's one... I'm not, it doesn't happen very often, but in that case, you can see that a series of internal decisions made, compounding one after the other, led to a long, long period where the lines of investigation were not questioned by anyone until 20 years on when we look back. Yeah. So I realise these things are rare, but kind of interests me that maybe we've got more checks and balances, I'd like to think.
I think, obviously, the Lady Angelini report was particularly interested in complaints and allegations, and she did look at criminality, but it's probably other areas that will be looked at and be addressed, the criminal side, and hopefully more solutions posed there.
Thank you very much.
I wonder if I can just come in with a couple of questions. One is, the first one is around sort of governance of PIRC, and the second one's a more general one around commissioners, the existence of commissioners, which I will explain in a moment. But in terms of governance, I note that the Angelini review stated that the commissioner had confirmed that she is planning to transform the Audit and Accountability Committee into a more formal board structure, with non-executive members being appointed through a transparent public appointments process. So I'm just wondering if you have an update on that recommendation, if those changes have been made, and if so, what is your view? Are they sufficient? Are they working?
Yes, those changes were made, and we had an appointment process which included Scottish Government personnel on the recruitment panel, and we have the Audit and Accountability Committee has a chair in the former Crown Agent Catherine Dyer and a number of non-executive directors that have got a wide range of experience, and we have our Audit and Accountability quarterly, and we had actually the sponsor team at the last one, so I think they could probably confirm that we are challenged in relation to governance areas as risk and budgets and generally all sorts of areas of governance are dealt with at that meeting. Our position in relation to the recommendation was, we're an organisation of 97 people. Do we really need a statutory board? Are we, you know, are we the size that we need to have a statutory board? The Crown don't have a statutory board. Scottish Prisons don't have a statutory board. So it was always our position that AAC could do that function, and they have been doing that function, and that we follow the public processes in relation to our terms of reference, our remuneration, etc. So, however, I fully accept that the respondents to the consultation were of the view that it was appropriate, that it was a statutory advisory board, and that's in the bill. And we will certainly work with the bill team and Scottish Government, and we'll then transform or transition the AAC into a statutory advisory board. So that's the position with it. But we have got that, and it has been in operation now for since 2022, I think it was, yeah.
For that. That maybe leads on quite nicely to a piece of work. I'm going to step outside the bill for a moment, but it is, I suppose, indirectly relevant. So you'll maybe be aware the Finance Committee in the Scottish Parliament is doing a piece of work looking at the sort of commissioner landscape in Scotland, and they're taking evidence on what is their effectiveness, what is their role. There are a number of new commissioner posts proposed, which you'll be aware of. But one of the things that they've been looking at is, why do we need commissioners in the first place? So what is it that is happening or not happening? So is it perhaps around public bodies, for example, not fulfilling some of their duties around the conduct of staff? Or is it perhaps a wider sort of societal issue, you know, cost of living crisis, and is that impacting on the public in general? So I know it's a really big question, but I'd be interested in, just from your perspective, you know, you have got a very demanding commissioner role, that there's absolutely no two doubts about that. Do you have any comment on just that wider analysis or question around the role of commissioners and do we need them? And I know you will say yes, and that's absolutely fine.
The position is that when they set up the PIRC, and it is odd to have an organisation in your name. Mm-hmm. So I am the Police Investigations and Review Commissioner, mm-hmm. which is a mouthful for anybody. So it's good it's abbreviated to PIRC. It's an odd concept, and I know that the report had looked at transforming it into a commission, of which I was supportive, and having mm-hmm. deputy commissioners. It was the way that it was set up, and there was obviously consideration given to having not a permanent person at the head of it. I'm not sure of what the rationale was behind that, but I have just accepted that's the position, mm-hmm. and have you know, obviously worked with it. There was obviously reference to deputy commissioners, and if I could just... one of the things that was highlighted was probably a lack of resilience at the management team, yeah. At PIRC, and I totally agreed in the fact of the absence of legal capacity, and obviously mm-hmm. Sharon is testament to that, that we have a head of legal services, and we still probably are have a need for more legal input. So we strengthened the team, and the Deputy Commissioner is a title, is fine, but the model that was suggested to me and was that they would be temporary, they would be on a kind of contracted period as well. And that really doesn't fit in, I think, it would destabilise the management team. Who are you going to bring in? And then they go every 3 years or every 5 years. Mm-hmm. So that model, once I'd become into the post and understood the post more, and once we'd strengthened the team, I suddenly realised that would actually be, you know, a destabilising factor. Mm-hmm. If the posts were permanent, they were just, you know, titles, and it could be the accountable officer. Or it might be the director of operations. Then that would be not destabilising, and you know, I can understand that. Mm-hmm. But actually, the reality is that once that model was suggested, it didn't really fit with PERC in that context. So, from that reason, that's why we haven't got it in the bill. I think persuaded the Scottish Government that would not be helpful to mm-hmm. Going forward with PERC. Mm-hmm. Generally, I'm not sure I'm probably the best person to talk about commissioners and the policy about commissioners generally, I'm afraid.
That's an interesting response, and I suppose it speaks to, or it's relevant to, the potential for your role to expand and the resource requirement around that. And I know that the issue of, sort of models of commissioners, if you like, is one that the committee, finance committee, will be looking at. I wonder if I can maybe just come back to the bill, and I'll just ask this question, and then I'll maybe bring in Sharon Dowley if you still want to follow up on the questions that you have. So one of the things that has come up in evidence, and it was from a lived experience witness who spoke about the weaponisation of the system against those making complaints. So, for example, elements of perhaps intimidation or instruction or obstruction. Now, I suppose I'm just interested in whether or not that's something that you recognise. Do you think that's a sort of fair characterisation? And as I say, you know, that was... that was commentary given in evidence to us by a person who'd been the subject of an investigation.
So just to be clear, this investigation by PERC or Police Scotland?
Both.
Again, sorry, is it criminal or... Sorry,
criminal, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, would you mind repeating the question? Sorry.
So in evidence, we heard from a witness, a former police officer,
right, okay,
who'd been the subject of a criminal investigation in relation to an incident that had happened on duty, and he subsequently left the service.
Yeah. Okay.
And during his evidence, he spoke about what he described as the weaponisation of the system against those making complaints. So that's quite a big thing,
yes,
to
yes,
say, a big claim to make. And I'm just interested in whether you have seen any evidence of that, if you recognise that characterisation.
No. What I would say is that if there's an allegation of criminality against a police officer, obviously that is very serious, and that is one of our core responsibilities, to investigate, and that has increased, obviously, mm-hmm, as we've discussed, and that's probably the bulk of our workload now, is looking at that areas of alleged criminality. And I think that, just as members of the public would expect, if there was an allegation about a member of the public, there has to be a process, and I understand if you're the person that's subject to it, then that's distressing, but there has to be a process. So if a member of the public, which is where our complaints come from, or sometimes it's from other police officers, but that's quite rare, but sometimes it can be, we have an obligation to investigate. Now, what happens in the first instance is that we have, since the standing order in 21, set up an assessment unit. So there's an assessment unit within the investigation team, and they will do a triage of the allegation, And some cases, there may be CCTV, which immediately shows that there's no validity to it or veracity to it. And that's the end. It will be reported back. There's no evidence, and nothing, you know, it will not be proceeded for further. And I would just mention that the rollout of the body-worn cameras, I think, will be a game-changer for ourselves and for the police officers who are where allegations are made, because we will, in many cases, be able to look at that CCTV body-worn camera footage and make a much more rapid decision than we can at the moment if there's no such footage, if the footage doesn't exist. So that's just an aside. So if the assessment, there is potential corroboration of the allegation, it goes to full investigation. And that goes to an investigator. And then once that's been done, it goes through the deputy senior investigator. And the ones that we think there's sufficient evidence or there's public interest will always come through the director of operations and finally myself before it goes to Crown. And we've actually recently added, we've employed what we call a report checker, but it's a person with legal background who is assisting providing more analysis of evidence, more robust analysis in that area, because we've got now so many more of these. We've done a lot of training with the investigators. We did training of all of them last year about writing reports better and about evidential considerations and about coming to about types of evidential use of Murov considerations and how we can prove cases. So we've done a lot of work, and we've got someone who's specifically tasked at looking at that area at the moment. So eventually, the final aspect of the QA will come to me, and obviously I've got the benefit of being a former prosecutor. So, and whilst it's not my decision, but we can then say we think there's sufficient and allude to where the corroboration comes from, and it goes to Crown. So there is a robust process at the beginning. If there is really no substance to it, it will not proceed. If there's substance, I haven't got a choice. I have an obligation to then investigate that and report it to the Crown. It's what we're here to do, and it's to give the public confidence. And then obviously some of those cases will go on, and there's a number of prosecutions ongoing at the moment from cases we've reported to the Crown.
Thanks very much for that. It's a comprehensive answer. I'm just going to bring in Sharon Dowie, and then we'll be drawing the session to a close. Sharon.
Right, thank you. And you've just answered one question I was going to ask about the body-worn cameras and if that would make a big difference to the investigations. So just to clarify, I've got two questions. One is if you could expand in your submission that there must be a lawful gateway for information sharing. And that was in terms of the proposals for the police BARD and advisory lists, if you could expand on that. And for Philip Chapman, I was just going to ask, Police Scotland have an obligation to notify cops of allegations against police officers when it can be reasonably inferred that a constable may have committed a criminal offence, which differs to members of the public, where there must also be a sufficiency of evidence. And we'd heard last week as well for the Federation saying that when it's an investigation into police, it starts up here rather than at the lowest level. So I wondered if you could explain what, if it can be reasonably inferred, means, and if you could...
In relation to the gateway, I'll maybe ask Sharon to pick that up,
fine,
if you don't mind.
The point in terms of the BARD and advisory list is obviously we would hold information that's relevant to that, and if you know the BARD and advisory list is to sit with the police authority, it's just making sure that having something within the legislation that says this is the lawfulness of sharing that information, because I think what we're finding now is people are working out that Park are a large information holder. It might be information that was previously only held by Police Scotland, but with us taking on the Article 3 and 5, we hold a lot more information, and people are coming to us to seek to recover that by whatever means that might be, either by simply just asking for it or by raising either proceedings by way of petitions for recovery of documents, or by looking to obtain it by way of freedom of information or by way of subject access. So there's a number of ways people can come to us for information, and you know, we don't particularly have a difficulty with that. We have a duty to make sure that we keep the information appropriately secure, depending on what it is, and that when we are sharing it, there's a lawful basis to do so. So it's just that if we are to be expected to share information to facilitate the Barton Advisory List, that, that obviously we can look to the route for that, as it will be this bill as it comes in into law, will be that's the basis on which we are sharing this information that comes from there. So it just protects the Commissioner's position in terms of ensuring that what we're doing is lawful.
Do you think it should be limited to who has access to see the list?
Well, we would only be sharing the information with those who have to see the list in any event, so I can see that being a relevant consideration.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, just in relation to your question, Dame Ailish referred in her report in relation to the high standards that the public expect from the police service and police officers in general. And part of that is obviously if there is an inference of a crime having been committed by a police officer, it's a completely different concept than a member of the public. CAPD have got a role in that, and I'm sure the next witness that you'll hear from can speak from the Crown position. But my understanding is that when PSD receive criminal allegations of any nature, they must, unless it's an Article 3 or a 5, which obviously now triaged under statutory instruction and come to the park for us to continue, they must be reported to the head of CAPD. I think it's 48 hours in relation to that inference of criminality to give them an awareness of what the allegation may be and then provide any instruction and parameters as they deem appropriate. And it's entirely up to the head of CAPD to direct any investigation to the park or back to Police Scotland for them to conduct the investigation, or indeed if they feel that there are wider implications, they could instruct another force to externally come in. But that's entirely a matter for the Crown, and we have no locus within that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. Okay, we're just a bit ahead of time, but I'm going to draw the session to a close. Thank you very much indeed for coming along this morning. I think that's been very helpful, so I appreciate your time. So on that, we'll just have a short suspension to allow a changeover of witnesses. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. So can I now welcome to this morning's meeting Mr Justin Farrell, Head of Criminal Allegations against Police Division of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. So welcome Mr Farrell, and thank you for providing written evidence to the committee. So looking to spend about an hour or so for this evidence session, and I wonder if I can maybe just kick things off and follow up on a line of questioning from Sharon Dowie with the PIRC just a short time ago. So it relates to criminal allegations against a police officer, and what we are aware of is that a criminal allegation is reported to Crown Office based on a reasonable inference that they've committed an offence which is different to ordinary members of the public, if you like. So I wonder if you could just advise or set out for the committee how you identify potentially malicious or vexatious complaints within the system and how it's ensured this identification takes place as early as possible in the process so that officers are not subject to lengthy, unnecessary investigations.
Okay, good morning, firstly, and thanks for inviting me along to provide evidence this morning. So, in answer to your questions, it's obviously important that within society that there's a confidence in the police. So, it's accepted that any allegation of criminality has to be seriously considered and, where appropriate, thoroughly and robustly investigated. So the standard that's employed is a lesser standard than what you would expect for the report of a report of crime against an individual. Usually an SPR would be submitted by the police where there is a sufficiency of evidence. And it's that lesser standard that you referred to as a test for a referral of a criminal allegation to the Crown by the police. And that's where there's a reasonable inference of criminality rather than a sufficiency of evidence. So it is a lesser standard, and that's reflected within conduct regulations, so that's backed by a statutory requirement for the police to provide that referral to the Crown. So where it is a lesser standard, as you say, we need to have some way of assessing it. And it's accepted that it's a low test. It's meant to be a reasonably low test. But it's more than just an allegation having been made. But it's not actually a great deal more before there's an obligation on the Crown to investigate it. So, for instance, someone might make an allegation and it may be demonstrably false, and it might be quickly confirmed as demonstrably false because their CCTV exists, or the person who who's the subject of the allegation was clearly and obviously elsewhere at the time that the allegation was said to have occurred. So those are reasonably simple in removing from the system, if you like, because the police will advise me about the existence of the complaint, but at the same time will provide me with information which allows me to assess it as not a credible complaint and therefore effectively bring the matter to an end without further investigation. But as I said, that's it's a low standard, the reasonable inference of criminality. So if I use another example of someone is subject to an arrest and makes an allegation that they were handled roughly by the police during that arrest, they were assaulted, then it's actually very difficult to set that aside without doing some further investigation into the circumstances, because you can establish that the person was arrested, you can establish that police effected that arrest and were present at the location. Their account is that this A has happened where they've been assaulted, and there might be evidence to suggest a contrary account from other witnesses, so you have to make an assessment of that evidence. And the way that you do that is you instruct further investigation at that early stage. In due course, a fuller report will be then made available to the Crown.
Okay, that's that's helpful. I was unaware of this sort of difference in threshold, I must admit, in terms of police officers being reported to the Crown. So it's helpful to sort of better understand that. So are you saying then that where perhaps more evidence, if you like, emerges in respect of an individual who's been reported to the Crown in relation to an incident, where that obviously emerges, that would then be passed to you for further consideration?
Yes. Yeah. So there will be further investigation instructed by myself, but either by the police through professional standards department or by PARC when I make a referral to PARC. And then that fuller report will be submitted to me. Upon receipt of that report, I will review the content and then instruct any further work that requires to be done. We'll also look at the source material, i.e. the statements and the productions, whether those are documentary or physical productions, and we'll make an assessment of all of that evidence. As I say, we may instruct further inquiries if there's something obviously missing, or we may then prepare our own report to submit to Crown Council with our recommendations on whether there should be a prosecution or not.
Thank you. And can I just go back to the you know, why we have this different threshold? You did set out at the beginning of your earlier response about, and I think I'm right in interpreting it as, you know, police officers, perhaps there's that higher expectation of adherence to discipline, good conduct, and so that in itself brings us to the point where we have a lower reporting threshold. I suppose I'm slightly struggling to sort of set that against the safeguarding issues that we touched on in the last session and compliance around human rights. So do you have a comment on that?
Well, as you know, in Scotland, the whole concept of policing is policing by consent. So for that to work, there has to be a sizeable majority within society who trust and have confidence that the police won't abuse the exceptional powers that are vested in them. So that's the serious principle that that underlies the more robust test, if you like, for referral of an allegation to the fiscal. And as I say, I've you know, personally, I have no difficulty with that because it allows us early sight of allegations, and it allows me then to instruct the investigating authorities, either the police or PARC, with regards to any other inquiries that I think should be made in order to test that allegation. In terms of where that leaves the officers in terms of their rights, I don't think there's any inconsistency necessarily with any of their you know, the rights that in that regard, because it is a robust process and it is effective in rooting out incredible and baseless complaints as it is in capturing those that that do have a substance to them and quite properly should be investigated robustly.
Thanks. And that's my final question on this is, once you have a report and have had time to consider it, presumably then the way in which a report is processed by Crown Office is as any other report would be in terms of the thresholds of evidence that are required within Scots law?
Ultimately, it's the same test that's applied with regards to the final decision as to prosecutorial action. So it's the test contained within the prosecution code for the Crown. So it is still, although there's a lesser entry point, if you like, we still have to bring it up to the evidential requirements that are required for a prosecution, which is that there's credible and reliable and sufficient admissible evidence and that it's in the public interest to prosecute. And that's exactly the same test prosecutorial decision-making point in the process as for any other criminal case.
Mm-hmm. That's really helpful clarification on that point. Okay, thanks for that. So I'm going to open it up and I'm going to bring in Rona Mackay and then Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Farrell. I wanted to ask you just, it's a bit of a follow-on from what you've been discussing with the Convener, but it's really in relation to the timescale involved in deciding whether to prosecute or not. So we've had witnesses advise that it's been, in their eyes, unacceptable, the length of time, and that's, you know, a shadow hanging over them for a long time. There was also the HMIPS report, which said that the data on which the 12-week target for decision-making was flawed, and there was a lack of robust and accurate management information about CAPD's work. I know you'd be aware of that report, so could you maybe address that, please, and just the timescales involved?
Yeah. I think firstly, any delay is unfortunate within the process, but there's certain there's different parts of the process at which delay can occur, and sometimes they combine to have a very, you know, negative impact over the event of an investigation. So, for instance, you have the investigative stage, which in itself can be delayed by complexity or by difficulty in engagement by individuals and that sort of thing. You then have the part of the process where you have the information that you require to make the decision, and you look to progress that and analyse it. And then ultimately, if there are to be proceedings, then you're exposed to the general delays within the court process as the case is prosecuted. So everything might work efficiently in that respect, and if that's the case, the delays shouldn't be too bad. But if any one part of that process attracts delay, then each part of it can compound the other effectively. Mm-hmm. What's within my gift is really that middle part. That's the part that following investigation and following the delivery of all the information we need to reach a prosecutorial decision is preparing that case for that decision to be made. Mm-hmm. That's the work within my unit. When I came into the role in 2000, I was aware of some delay within the progression of the cases, and I wasn't satisfied that the management information that was available was particularly accurate. And that was generally because there were flaws in the way that we were tracking the cases at that time. There was a very tight target to meet, 12 weeks, I think you mentioned mm-hmm. there. And it was nigh on impossible to meet that target as a linear target, in as much as a report would come in, the unit would instruct further work. They were never getting a return on that work before the target had expired, because you need to give the investigators time to do their job, which meant that they developed a technique of freezing the target within CAPD whenever you asked for further work to be done, and then you unfroze it when that product became available for you to do your part of the process. Now, that just provides inaccurate information, because you could have a report that had met target in terms of comparison against that process, but had actually been in the unit for over a year. So it didn't give you accurate or good data in respect of what the actual delay had been. So I did away with that effectively and brought in a new target, which was more generous in terms of time given to progress the work, but which was a linear target that you can easily assess the length of time within the unit against. And that target is that we progress and conclude 75% of our cases reported to us within the six-month period. And we're comfortably meeting that since that was introduced in 2021. Mm. So effectively what that tells you is that I think last year it was a 95% year performance during the whole of the year against that target. It tells you that a huge proportion of our work is being delivered and concluded within that 6-month period. So that's a lot faster than it had been getting throughput in the past. Mm-hmm. And as I said, to some extent, the fact you don't need to worry about that middle part means that you don't the effects of the other two parts don't compound as much to increase the overall journey of a case.
Okay, thank you.
In general, I think that is a much improved position since 2021. And I think in general we are progressing work a lot quicker. I do concede though that there are complicated, complex investigations that take a lot of time to investigate, and I do concede that on occasion the criminal justice process generally is not perhaps going through the business as efficiently as it perhaps could. But of course there's lots of factors in respect of that, you know, adjournments and witness availability, or whatever it might be, that can account to that, that falls out with the control of any one organisation or person.
Thank you, that's helpful. It seems to me there's a lot of, for want of a better word, players in all of this, different organisations doing different things. In your opinion, would it not be better for you to, when you're presented with a case, to have had all that investigatory work done before you make the decision whether or not to prosecute? Because it seems to me that it's been done by some but not completed, and then you're doing it. That's a bit cumbersome, is it not?
Yeah, ultimately our job is to make the legal assessment in respect of the case, because we are qualified to do that, we are lawyers. So ultimately you have the investigators, Park and the police, in gathering information and compiling information and concluding inquiries that you've instructed that you think will provide an evidential basis to make a decision upon. But when that material comes to us, we then have to review all of that source material, what was seized early in the investigation, what becomes seized after our further instructions, and we make an assessment of that source material. Information within statements, information within documents, any physical evidence, CCTV, transcripts from phone calls, etc., etc. And we make, we draw that together as an evidential package and make an assessment with regards sufficiency of evidence. And that all takes time, and that's a separate process from the in-gathering of information.
Yeah, no, I understand what you're saying. Is there a way it could be streamlined, in your opinion? I'm trying to sort of get at. Is there a way, any one thing that you think could happen that would be helpful to you and the witness and complainant?
I would always concede that in any process you can make improvements, you can identify parts of it that could be improved. But I have to, you know, my honest assessment is that that there's no silver bullet that would make significant differences in terms of how each part of the process is pursued and concluded.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Sharon Dowie, then Russell Finlay.
Thank you. It's probably following on for the questioning you've already had. I'm just kind of interested in some of the timescales. You'd said about some of the allegations that come to you about police officers, there's already evidence there straight away that you know that it's maybe malicious, so it gets put away straight away. What's the timescale on ones that have maybe came from somebody who's been arrested, they've said that there's been excessive force? So that's just coming straight to you, but what's the timescale on getting evidence?
Yes, so we'll be notified within 48 hours of the allegation having been made. The police will identify that as a criminal allegation and tell us about it. The reason they do that is to allow me to make an assessment as to whether to leave it with the police professional standards department to investigate, or whether to refer it to PUC for investigation.
So if you've not got any evidence, how do you know that?
You've got the nature of the allegation that's been made. So and generally, if it's a serious allegation, then I'll elect to refer it to PUC. Or if there's something about the circumstances that suggest an additional layer of independence or impartiality is required. But you're right, quite often at the initial stage, you don't have a great deal of information.
So one of the witnesses that we had said that he'd actually been put onto restricted duties and actually told that he was a danger to the public. And it ended up going all the way right through to prosecution. I think it was 900 days between the day that it happened and the day it finished.
Yes.
But he hadn't actually been informed why he was being put in restricted duties. So is that normal? Is that acceptable?
Well, that's an internal matter for the police. What the police decide to do with employees that are subject to criminal allegations is a matter for them. But in terms of the process, we would have been told about that. We would have then instructed a report. And I can't speak about individual cases, obviously, but the usual timescale for the police to then provide a full report to us would be 56 days. That's how much... that's their target for delivering a report to us. And then once it's delivered to us, our target is now the six-month linear target to report that to Crown Council for a decision on prosecution or no prosecution. And thereafter, if it is to be prosecuted, it would then be proceeded with within the court process.
So when you get the initial report, would you not, in quite a quick timescale, would you, because 56 days is quite long, would you not expect to get maybe a statement from the person that's been accused of the crime to actually see what their version of events was?
Well, at that stage, you do have the statement, you have the allegation. So you're aware of the allegation, but you don't have any witness statements or you don't have any other productions that might be relevant to the allegation, because you need to provide the police some time to carry out that investigation. The ones that we can make a quick decision on are the ones that are demonstrably false. So you can make quick decisions on those. So, you know, someone's claiming a police officer is at point A and has done something to them, and they're quite clear about the identity of that officer, you can establish that that officer was never at point A at that time. So that's not a credible allegation. So you can quite often discount those very, very quickly. But as I said before, there's others that you can't discount. You have a statement from the person making the complaint, or at least a heads of complaint form from them. So you know the nature of the allegation, but you have to then provide the police or PERC some time to actually investigate that in order to bring some evidence to bear on the matter.
Right. So on the vast majority of complaints, I think there's less than 10% of them are actually prosecuted, is that right?
That's accurate, yes.
Right. So do you think that the police, and I know we've got to keep them at a higher standard, but do you think, regardless of whether there's sufficient evidence, that the police have been obliged to report to your department once a complaint of criminality is made as an effective system?
I don't have any difficulty with that system. It's a matter for others as to whether that's an acceptable... whether the lesser test is an acceptable test. As a prosecutor, a public prosecutor, I don't have any difficulty with that, with the current process.
So the communication with the police officer that's been accused, that's probably something more to do with the police procedures then?
Yes, yes.
So the fact that he wasn't told why he was... he should really have been told at the time, you've been put onto restricted duties and this is why,
yes,
and he should have taken a statement.
In my experience, Police Scotland... will put a welfare package in place in terms of police officers who have had criminal allegations made against them. I think the terms of that package will differ from between case to case, but it's a matter for Police Scotland, and I don't really have a remit or a detailed knowledge of that.
Okay. How do you decide who should investigate between PSD, PERC, or another police force, and why would it go to another police force? Why would it be necessary? Why would it not just stay with PERC?
So the first one is how do I usually decide? If it's a simple, straightforward allegation, reasonably minor, and obviously, you know, I accept that for the individuals making any complaint, they're all serious. No. But if it objectively it's not the most serious, then I may elect to leave that with Professional Standards Department rather than refer to PERC, because I know that PERC have limited capacity ultimately in order to investigate all. You know, they couldn't take all complaints. But in addition to that, If it's a minor road traffic matter, for instance, I would be more inclined to leave that with PSD to investigate, because by referring to PERC, you are in building a slight delay in the system, because PERC have to then liaise with the police to in-gather information, whereas the police already have a lot of that information in their system in terms of, you know, who attended an incident, who was driving towards that incident. So they can immediately carry out that investigation, and minor road traffic matters have a time bar on them. I have to make a prosecutorial decision, and if it's to proceed, it has to proceed within 6 months. So you look to reduce delay. And there's low risk in leaving that with professional standards, because there's no suggestion that they won't do a thorough investigative job on any such allegation. So that's the sort of thing that I leave routinely with Police Scotland. Yeah. However, if it's a serious matter involving death or serious injury, then my presumption is that I will refer it to the PERC, and I would then have to carefully analyse my and provide reasoning effectively and an audit of my decision making if I decided to leave an allegation like that with Police Scotland rather than to refer it to the PERC. So there's no simple answer to the question. It is to some extent left to my discretion or the discretion of those working with me within criminal allegations against police department. But we are a specialist unit, and we have got now an experience and a sense of all of the factors that should be taken in respect of when you should be referring a matter to PERC rather than to police. And of course, as I'm sure you've heard from Michelle this morning, since October 2001, I issued a standing instruction where all assault allegations now automatically go to the PERC from the police. So we never leave those with the police. So I don't know if that assists.
Yeah, that's fine. Why would it go to another police force?
We have, that's an exceptional
step. It's
absolutely exceptional. It's only happened twice, within my knowledge, since the creation of Cap D. And there were very particular complexities around both of those investigations. There had been in the other investigations in the past, but nevertheless, questions remained. And those previous investigations had been conducted with Police Scotland. So, and PERC had been involved in some of them as well. So they had already been involved, and we wanted a fresh perspective. So there had to be a very exceptional arrangement made for Merseyside Police to come in and do a completely independent investigation.
Right, okay. Well, one of the biggest complaints we've had is about the time it takes to do a lot of the things. And HM Chief Inspector of Constabulary had basically said that it takes far too long for the criminal justice organisations to investigate criminal complaints. There's a general lack of pace applied to the investigations. And he also said that there was a lack of communication between the three parties involved, so Police Scotland, PERC and COPS. Do you think that what we've got in the bill is going to reduce these timescales?
I'm not sure there's any one provision within the bill that addresses that, but I would refer you back to what evidence I gave earlier with regards the reduction in timescales generally. I've very much taken responsibility for COPFFs as part of that. What I can add is that there is very good liaison now between PERC, PSD and myself on behalf of the Crown. I don't know for sure what level of liaison existed before, mm-hmm. but it is regular now, I don't recognise that critique.
Yeah, it did sound in the other evidence as if there had been better communication, so thank you.
Russell Finlay, then Pauline.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Farrell. I'd like to return to the point that was raised by Rona Mackay, and that's in HM Inspector of Prosecution report from 2021. And it talked about Cap D freezing cases. You've already referred to that. But I think when you look at the detail of that report, it's actually quite shocking. It said that cases were frozen while you were in gathering or requesting additional work to be done. And in some cases, I think they reset the clock rather than just paused it.
I think that had occurred in a couple of cases, and obviously that was a factor that I took into account following my arrival as to why that couldn't persist.
I mean, the language used by the inspector was that this was open to abuse, was being used inappropriately for no discernible reason. CAPD had developed an unhealthy and misguided approach to managing its targets, masked the reality of what was happening, and it misled everyone from the general public right through to the Lord Advocate. So you've put that right, I understand, but given the HM report, and given that we've heard so much evidence from witnesses already about a lack of trust, do you believe that the public can now trust the data coming from CAPD?
They can absolutely trust the data that's now coming from CAPD, yes.
Right, OK. I mean, delays, as my colleague Sharon Dowes mentioned, cause huge problems for complainers and indeed for police officers. We heard evidence from one officer whose case took 900 days from start to finish before he was cleared, and he spoke of colleagues having taken their own lives while being subject to complaints. Have CAPD, in cases where you're aware of officers who've died from suicide, have you then liaised with Crown Office colleagues to share that information with them?
I was aware of those allegations that there had been suicides linked with criminal inquiries when I first started way back in 2020, 2021. And when I looked at the cases, there was only one case involving the death of an officer that was actually being investigated at CAPD. But nevertheless, there had been, you know, a delay in respect of that particular case. So officer welfare is something that I do keep it at the front of my mind in respect of progressing the work through the department.
So that case, you'd have shared your information with someone else in the Crown?
The head at the time of the SFIU, the Scottish Fatalities Investigation Unit, and myself shared information in respect of that inquiry. I think it had come from a comment that had been made by a senior officer. And of course, we assessed that commentary in order to see whether what was said was accurate. And I think he had made reference to five officers, and as I say, only one of them had been subject to a criminal investigation. Yeah. I think the other four were subject to non-criminal misconduct processes that were within the police.
Right.
So we
did
a careful analysis with regard to the case we had, and we discovered that there had been some delay, but the delay in that case, by recollection, was due to non-engagement with the victim who'd made a complaint initially and then had been difficult to trace thereafter in order to pursue other questions with that individual.
The Crown Office website has been updated, I think, fairly recently to say that acknowledge the fact that some people may have a fundamental lack of trust or confidence that their complaint will be properly advanced by Police Scotland.
Yes.
However, and that sounds great, it puts that out there, but you would then ordinarily direct these same people back to Police Scotland?
Yes, and again, the reason for that is because I don't have the information that I need in order to contextualise an allegation. So I don't have access to police systems that allow me to make checks as to whether police officers are on duty, are attending an incident. The Police Scotland have that. Plus, I don't have the powers of a constable, so I can't attend upon individuals and take a statement that can then later be relied upon in court. Investigators have those powers. So I refer it back in order for the basics to be carried out by those that are qualified to do that.
Sure, yeah.
And then they come back to me with further information, allowing me to make a decision on how to progress it thereafter.
That's based entirely on the information you're getting back being accurate?
Yes. I mean, some of the difficulty is that when we take a complaint direct from a member of the public, it involves also misconduct allegations as well as criminal allegations. So there has to be a way of us referring that back to the police. But with regard to your last point, I'm always relying on the police to provide information which they're statutorily bound to provide to me.
Yeah,
I have to rely on them to do
it. And that leads me to my next question, which is that we've also heard evidence of cases in which complainers, whether they be members of the public or police officers, believed that what they had imparted had been subsequently shared with Cap Diaz as right and proper, and it hadn't been the case. Are you confident that since a lot of the more scrutiny has been applied on these particular cases and these wider issues, that that's improved, or is the legislation, can the legislation perhaps be improved to ensure that that does happen?
My sense of it is that it has improved, and the reason I say that is because I have no evidential basis on which to reach a conclusion that I'm not being told about every allegation that I should be told about. Also within that, there are checks and balances, if you like, within the process. So one of those checks and balances is that if the police categorise something as non-criminal, that a complainer considers is criminal, and then deals with it on that basis, and that person's dissatisfied, then they can come direct to Cap D, and they often do. And then me and my team then review the way that that's been handled at that stage. Similarly, if something goes through the process as non-criminal and the complainer's not really satisfied with that but doesn't actually challenge it, and it goes to PERC for a case handling review, PERC then have a memorandum of understanding with CAPD whereby if there's anything criminal that they find when they're dealing with it as a case handling review, they'll refer it to CAPD at that point. So there's various ways where it can come back to CAPD.
I think that answer quite neatly illustrates how complicated a landscape it is for a member of the public. You know, it can do this. I mean, if you looked at it as a flowchart, it would be quite confusing. And therefore, you know, communication with complainers, again, whether it be police officers or members of the public, is absolutely vital. And going back to the HMIP report, it found that of the 80 cases they looked at, 4 in 10, the communication was unsatisfactory from CAPD. And they've got some quite detailed accounts, which some of which are pretty shocking, frankly. I know you've presumably, having come in since or at the time of this report, what can you say now about the quality of communication from CAPD?
Well, following the inspectorate's report, where they made that assessment, we've got now a completely revised communication strategy. So we've got more direct communication with complainers, and we've got more communication at every part of the process. So a small example, we didn't used to advise a complainer when we received a report, a substantive investigative report. We now do. Yeah. We didn't necessarily always tell a complainer if there was going to be a delay. If we do go beyond the six-month target, we didn't perhaps before communicate and tell people that we were beyond the six-month target. We now do. So there's a whole new, you know, communication strategy
and
put in.
Presumably
place.
You tell them when a final decision's made. Yeah, that's a matter of routine.
It is now,
yeah.
Yes. So yeah. Again, before, when the inspector did her investigation, it was found that we didn't always tell complainers the outcome of their complaint. And I think that was... It was really a misdirection on the part of CAPD, but I think CAPD previously had thought had aligned itself with the processes in respect of all other criminal reports. So in all other criminal reports, you make a prosecutorial decision. You don't necessarily tell everyone in terms of what that decision is. And I think we folded it in with that process. But CAPD is a specialist unit, and there should be a specialist approach. Yeah. That was lacking, and we've addressed that.
I'm allowed to ask one more. No.
Can I just quickly, before you ask your final question, in terms of access to police information, we spoke earlier with PERC in relation to access to the Centurion system that Police Scotland have. Is that? I take it you don't have access to that?
I don't have access to Centurion.
No.
No, and nor do I consider that I need it, because it principally it focuses on all complaints against the police. And I have no remit in respect of access to non-criminal complaints, which makes up the majority of the data that's on that database.
Thank you, that's helpful. And final question? Yes. On the bill?
So, cases can be prosecuted or not prosecuted, but you also presumably have the same alternative disposals, diversion to prosecution. Are they utilised for police officers?
They could be. They're not regularly used as an outcome against police officer, but if it is the appropriate outcome, then it will be utilised.
Do you have any data that you could share with us? Because it would be quite interesting to see.
I think it's, as one of the other members of the committee said, we don't have a great deal of prosecutions in any particular year. It's less than 10% of the cases reported.
Yeah.
And I don't have data in terms of outcome through the courts. To some extent, that's because once we have made a prosecutorial decision, we pass the case on to our local court colleagues, and they prosecute it locally across the country.
Oh.
And we don't always get information back with regards to outcome, or at least we don't record that anywhere once we get that information.
Can they then make a decision to divert from prosecution?
No, the prosecutorial decision and how the case is to be dealt with is made by then. So effectively, at the point that decision would be made, it would be Crown Council that would usually make the decision on a Cap D case, because there would be a sufficiency of evidence. So the case would be reported to Crown Council, because we report every case to Crown Council where there's a sufficiency. And if Crown Council believe that there should be proceedings and that the appropriate prosecutorial action is the use of a diversion, then that will be their recommendation, which will then go to one of the law officers, either the Lord Advocate or the Solicitor General, to endorse that decision, and then that will happen at that stage. So if it's a diversion, it will come back to us, and then we will action that diversion at that stage, and it won't go to the local prosecutor. If it's a prosecution, then it will go to the local prosecutor. What I'm saying in terms of statistics, we don't have enough cases where anything is statistically relevant enough, to be perfectly honest. We'd be talking about numbers in the tens over a course of years.
It'd be just quite interesting, given the increased use of diversion from prosecution within the broader criminal justice system, if we're seeing similar mirroring of that in the cases you deal with. But
There's no reason why you wouldn't, and I'm confident that the prosecution code is applied uniformly by all prosecutors. So if that is the right outcome, then I'm sure that's the outcome that's been reached.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
McNeill.
Good morning.
Morning.
I wanted to begin by asking you about this lower standard that you mentioned. I think that's the first time I was aware of that. Do you know, is that contained in law or guidance, or where does that come from?
Yes. So it was there when I arrived in Cap D, so that was, I had to deal with that because it was contained within statute. It's within Section 9 of the Police and Conduct Regulations 2014, and that puts an obligation on the Deputy Chief Constable to refer any matters inferring criminality to the appropriate prosecutor, is the language used for an assessment. So that's there, and we have to incorporate that within our system.
Is that not quite odd for a prosecutor to deal with, given that in all other cases there's a certain standard that you apply in terms of sufficiency, but when it comes to police officers, you've got to do something completely different?
The answer to that is yes. It's an element that as a prosecutor of 24 years standing, I had to become aware of when I moved to dealing with criminal allegations against the police. But to some extent, that's the rationale behind the National Specialist Unit. It is slightly different. You're applying the same prosecutorial principles to the work, but the processes are different, there's no doubt about that. But that's why it benefits from specialism and people being allowed to build a bit of experience and becoming familiar with these peculiarities.
Thank you. So I'm trying to get my head around all the different categories of complaints and criminality that police officers might be accused of. I don't know if you alluded to earlier in answer to one of my colleagues. I mean, I suppose a typical example of a complaint might be in the middle of an arrest where a member of the public says excessive force was used, so you've effectively assaulted me. Given this low test, then is there not quite a fine line in those cases?
There can be, but that's why any investigation needs to be thorough and robust, so that you take all of the witness statements that may be relevant and you make an assessment in respect of that evidence and you assess it as best you can for credibility and reliability.
Right.
So you test it. The way you do that is you test it against the other evidence that's available in order to see whether any particular person's account is consistent with the weight of the other evidence.
So in terms of the process, if a member of the public, do they report that to PIRC first then? Is that how it works?
Most usually, someone will make a complaint against the police to the police. Whether that's non-criminal or whether that is criminal. And that works effectively, because the police then have a record of that complaint, can put it on Centurion and track it through the process. If it is a criminal allegation, the police have a statutory obligation to report it to us. If it's a non-criminal allegation, they have an obligation to address that complaint themselves. So that's the kind of basis of the system. When a criminal allegation comes to me, I will make a decision at that stage as to whether it remains with Police Scotland or whether PIRC should conduct a substantive investigation.
Right, I see. So in the first instance, it will come to you, having been reported to the police.
I'll be notified, yes.
And you can make a decision about whether there's sufficiency of evidence or not at that point. And if you think there might be...
Sorry, just to clarify, I don't make a decision on sufficiency at that point.
Right.
At that point, I assess whether there's a reasonable inference of criminality.
A reasonable inference of criminality. Yes. And if you think there is, then that's where PIRC...
We move it forward.
Right. So I wanted to ask you about the timescales in relation to all this, and so in the circumstances for so PIRC's now investigating the criminal case. So they can take up to 3 months.
Yes.
And they said they're largely meeting those types, but you can take up to 6 months.
Yes.
And we've got the figures about, you know, you're clearly doing better than previously was the case.
Yes.
And my colleagues have mentioned some long cases. It's still quite a long time, isn't it, really, 9 months before it can even get to court?
It is, but again, that's as a consequence of the thoroughness and robustness of the process. And if you compare that against any other criminality, it doesn't take so long to make a decision, but there's not as much analysis of the evidence made in those cases. You're effectively not testing the evidence in those cases to the same extent that you're testing evidence when a criminal allegation against a police officer is made for on-duty offending. And part of the rationale behind testing the evidence is that when a police officer is deployed in duties, they're often deployed in contentious circumstances.
Yeah.
And people have very different perspectives with regards to what's happening or whether any particular action is appropriate. So it's worth doing the investigation up front in order to test the veracity, because you don't want to be prosecuting officers who should not be prosecuted because the allegation has no credibility or no basis in fact or even where there's an insufficiency of evidence.
So, I mean, as a layperson, I'm just wondering why we need Park and the Crown on. I'm just not fully understanding this. But Park said to me when I asked them that they prepared quite a thorough report for Crown Office in the investigation. So what part of it is necessary for the Crown? I mean, do we need this? Could the Crown not do it all if you're doing it anyway? Is there not a duplication?
We're not trained investigators. We're not detectives. Right. We can't detect in the same way as trained investigators can. We don't have the powers of constables. We're effectively lawyers or civil servants that are trained to prepping those cases, to interview witnesses and put together a report, delivering a legal product.
What is the difference, really? So what are Park doing? I understand that point.
Yeah.
But well, so there's an allegation. You're saying that... So Park will ask to see all the people concerned and take statements from them and draw up a report?
Yes, yeah. Yeah, so they'll deploy their resource and go and carry out investigations. So they'll, in its simplest terms, they'll get into a car and they'll drive to where they have to drive to, and they'll look at locus and they'll investigate in the wider sense.
Right.
They'll seize CCTV, they'll seize other documents and productions because they have the powers of a constable that allows them to do that. We cannot do that. Because we're lawyers
and
we make the legal assessment. They do the investigation, they're the experts in that, as are PSD. And I should say that my assessment is that I get a good quality report from both Park and from PSD because they're trained investigators. Right. But when it comes to me, we then try to identify what other evidence might be available and useful, and then we'll instruct further inquiry. It doesn't mean that we can do the inquiry. We can instruct them to do it on our behalf.
Right.
They go out with
Understand.
The powers that they
That's
have
helpful.
And do that and feed that back in.
So in the case of an accusation of assault, one that I thought might be typical, I mentioned an accusation that when you handcuffed me, you actually assaulted me or something like
yes.
that. Why would it take 6 months for the Crown to really decide on sufficiency of evidence in what is quite a simple...
Well, it doesn't. I mean, the short answer is it doesn't usually take that long. We usually report those well within targets, or at least I would hope we were doing that, because it's we don't have a particularly nuanced management information system where I can track how long each type of case is taking.
Right.
And some of that is because of the way that the cases have to be reported to us, for confidentiality and legal reasons. We get a hard copy report, effectively, which is different from an electronic report in all the other areas of business. But setting that aside, it just means that I have less management information than other areas of COPFS business. But generally, if it's a simple case, we're reporting it quickly. If it's less simple, it will take longer to report and we're meeting our target.
Thank you. Can you clarify something you said to Sharon Dowie? Because this matter came up in previous evidence that the case we looked at, the police officer, he was suspended on restricted duties, and he wasn't allowed to know the allegations against him. And the suggestion was in that evidence that there might be legal reasons why the... What's the position on that?
He's entitled to know what the allegation against him is.
Right. So that's something...
And I'm surprised
that
he wouldn't have known that.
I
can't speak to the case, but the police, when they're providing that welfare to an officer who's under investigation, should be providing them with information to allow them to know, in general terms, what the allegation is. Of course, they can't... share any of the evidential product, but they can let them know what they've been investigated for.
Mm-hmm. I think that's really interesting and helpful, because I think we thought it might be a legal reason for that, and now we know there isn't. It's something that we can pursue. Two further questions to finish off. in cases of, I want to keep using the kind of example, a simple example. So on the face of it, that's a criminal case that a police officer accused of assault and may go to court and the court may find the officer not guilty.
Yes.
So how can it still be a misconduct issue? Maybe you can answer that. I'm struggling to understand why the police Scotland still pursue the officer for misconduct in something that a court has dealt with. Now, I could understand if there were other issues, so yes. Understand it. Yes. Other separate issues, then they have to be dealt with. But if it's a simple case of an assault, surely the matter is dealt with at the court.
I think the answer comes down to the standard of proof that's required. And obviously in a criminal trial, it's beyond a reasonable doubt, which is a high standard of proof.
Right.
And sometimes if there is an acquittal, then the rationale provided by the court what would be that the standard of evidence didn't meet that high test. It doesn't mean that whatever was alleged didn't happen. And that's where there still might be substance to the allegation that the police wish to address as a misconduct matter.
OK, thank you. And just lastly, Recommendation 46, the ability to report directly to criminal allegations against Police Division of the Crown and Procurator Fiscal Service, a complaint of a crime by a police officer, should be much better publicised and made more accessible to the public by the Crown Office. Just wonder why you thought that was the case, as to why a complaint should be widely publicised. Why is that?
I think
what was meant by that?
I think when Dame Eilish was conducting her review, mm-hmm. There was some commentary with regards some individuals were not aware that they could come directly to the Crown in order to make a complaint. It's always been the case that any individual can make any allegation of criminality direct to the Crown. However, it's not the most efficient way of reporting a crime because we can't go and attend to that crime. And that's similar for criminal allegations against police. They can come direct to Cap D, but it's not the most efficient way because it doesn't fold into the usual processes. So we have to come up with an exceptional arrangement in terms of moving that forward. Now, I've got no difficulty with someone that's completely lost confidence in the police or trust with the police in coming to me, but the trade-off is that the investigation may take longer and be less efficient and have to be run almost on an exceptional basis rather than the routine processes that we have in place.
I understand you.
But nevertheless, following Dame Eilish's review, we did do more to publicise that direct route with the caveats that you can do it, but still the most efficient and best way of doing it is going through the usual process.
That makes sense. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. I wonder if I can just come in with a couple of questions. The first one relates to the functions of PIRC particularly around police officers who have left service. So in the bill, it clarifies the definition of a person serving with the police to allow the PIRC to investigate allegations of criminality against officers who have left the service,
yes.
Where the behaviour was prior to joining or while they were off duty. And I think in your submission, you provided some evidence of how this could impact on you no longer having to run parallel investigations in certain circumstances. Do you envisage that this could impact on any other aspects of CAPD's work or CAPD's role, for example, in only dealing with on-duty criminality currently?
That particular provision will be of assistance to CAPD and the investigative process.
Okay.
And that is because at the moment I do have to instruct parallel investigations on occasion. Mm-hmm. Not often, but where you have an allegation that involves more than one officer and some of the officers are retired or resigned or have otherwise left the police force and some of the officers are still in employment, Park can do those still employed, but Police Scotland must do the people who have left, because Park doesn't have a statutory power to investigate non-police officers. So that's not ideal, because effectively I've got two different investigative agencies investigating the same incident.
Yeah.
And we have to... There's practical issues in respect of, you know, when the reports are coming in, and then how you pull that all of that information together.
Mm-hmm.
It'd be much simpler if it was a case where I've obviously made the decision that Park's the appropriate investigative agency, because I've referred part of it to Park.
Mm-hmm.
It'd be much better if Park could do all of that. So that would be very helpful, that provision, and would be a huge improvement just on efficiencies around how we deal with that.
Right.
There's actually a similar provision, I don't know if you're coming on to it, but it's a similar provision in as much as Park currently don't have a remit to investigate officers from other parts of the United Kingdom
mm-hmm.
that are on deployment in Scotland.
Mm-hmm.
And similar issues can arise there. Mm-hmm. So in some of the scoping for COP 27, 28, so long ago, but for the COP conference, we scoped and tried to come up with a process as to what would happen if there were a significant number of issues arising involving officers from other parts of the
mm-hmm.
United Kingdom, and that scoping led us to conclude that there would have to be parallel investigations, which again mm-hmm. is not ideal. So if Park do have the statutory power to investigate officers deployed on mutual aid or whatever
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
The policing basis is, then that would be very helpful, because they could do it against officers from elsewhere as well mm-hmm. as the Scottish officers at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
And we've got one investigation instead of more than one.
Mm-hmm. That's very interesting, because I suppose we perhaps underestimate just the number of occasions when there are officers from outside Police Scotland area actually on duty in Scotland for a variety of reasons. So that's very interesting. I wonder if I can just finish off with another question, this time relating to the duty of candour. And we spoke earlier about the duty of candour when Perk were in. And I think some of the questions that you've been responding to have been around delays experienced with investigations. And we're aware that PERC have made a sort of suggestion around perhaps incorporating a sort of duty to cooperate into the duty of candour, whereby officers are required to provide statements, operational statements, timeously, but where their status is clearly that of a witness.
Yes.
So in relation to the introduction of a statutory duty of candour, I wonder if you could advise, if CAPD currently experience issues arising from delayed statements, I think probably the answer will be yes, or other information from Police Scotland, and if the proposal that PERC have made around incorporating a requirement to produce operational statements would be helpful for CAPD.
In general terms, the answer is that I don't routinely experience delays
okay.
in gathering of statements from police officers.
Mm-hmm.
They routinely engage with the investigative process.
Mm-hmm.
I think in the past where there have been issues, it's where there has been a obviously serious incident followed by post-incident management process, which involves the taking of statements of officers involved. And I think the officers themselves have been confused as to the extent and purpose for engaging and for those statements being taken. And I think they've had maybe conflicting advice from the Federation, for instance,
mm-hmm.
as to
yeah.
whether they should engage. Now, I think the duty of candour that's proposed within the bill will address that to some extent
mm-hmm.
and say the expectation is that you will engage in investigations where there's a good reason for you to engage in investigations
mm-hmm.
and you're expected to do that and there's a professional standard linked to that, and if you don't do that, then there might be consequences. So I think all of that is helpful. Mm-hmm. In terms of the duty of cooperation, I think in general terms, it would be great if we could, if it could be achieved. Mm-hmm. However, there are real difficulties in achieving that in a way that would be Article 6 compliant. Yeah. Because once you get into the area of compelling someone to attend mm-hmm. for interview and attach potentially punitive consequences for not attending, then you could get into difficulties if they incriminate themselves in using that product in any event. So I think if it could be drafted, great. But I think I think it was looked at in the process of putting this bill together, mm-hmm. and the parliamentary drafts people couldn't come up with a way of squaring that circle, mm-hmm. and therefore decided to leave it aside. Meantime,
mm-hmm. that's very helpful. And of course, the other point that I was thinking about also was in the and probably very very infrequent circumstances where an officer's status may change from witness to suspect.
Yes.
And then how does that work?
Well, I think the duty of candour doesn't impact upon that, because mm-hmm. effectively they're not being compelled to attend. Mm-hmm. There's an expectation they'll engage, but if suspicion hasn't crystallised them upon mm-hmm. them at that point as being a potential suspect, then they're engaging with the process as a witness voluntarily. And if they provide information which is contrary to their own interests, then they're not being compelled to provide that information, mm-hmm. and there's a potential that the courts, in applying Article 6 principles, will then allow that evidence to be led. I'm not convinced that the court would allow that evidence to be led if there was a compulsion attached to to that information. And it may be the case that at the start of inquiry you don't have enough information for suspicion to crystallise. So you might interview someone as a witness at an early stage of an investigation that then becomes a suspect. But at the point that they become a suspect, they should be cautioned. Yeah. And they should be told that they don't, anything that they do say will be noted. They may be using the evidence, but they don't need to say anything. Yeah. Yeah. It's squaring that circle. So I can understand that why PIRC would think that a duty of cooperation was very attractive for them to compel an officer to come along and meet with them when they direct that should happen. But it has to be Article 6 compliant, and that's the difficulty.
That's the tricky bit. Okay, thank you very much indeed. So that brings us up to time. So thank you, Mr. Farrell, for joining us this morning. That's been very helpful. And that concludes the public part of our meeting. And we'll now move into private session. Thank you.
Thanks.